All right. Welcome to the Bardic Inspiration Podcast. I'm your host, Brad the Bard. And today, joining me is Phill Groff, a firearms instructor, BJJ practitioner, and professional badass. My bad about the whole...
Big word, man. It's too early, in the broadcast for that.
It's too late. Jeez. Oof. So what's up, man? I have a quote I want to run by you, and I want to get your opinion of.
All right.
So this is one that I kind of hold near and dear. But the quote goes, the best tool against bad men who are skilled at violence is good men who are skilled at violence. Can you give me a reflection on that?
Yeah, man, true words. I mean, it's a violent world, and you can stick your head in the sand and believe it's not going to happen and believe it doesn't exist, or you can train and prepare for it. And that's foot, fist, knife, gun, tank, ballistic missile, submarine. I don't care what it is, man. There's violent people. And the only thing that stops violence isn't thoughts and prayers. It's not well wishes or, like, you know, hug them into submission. Like, that's not going to work. It takes violence to stop violence. So, Yeah, that's true words. Yep. That's what I'd say about
fight
that.
Fire with fire.
True words, man. Yeah, real true words.
Mm-hmm. Awesome, man. So, you are a special tactics and, like, firearms instructor that goes through a lot of awesome stuff, including like these vehicle things where you're popping out of like these riddled with holes.
Yeah, cars. Shot to pieces. Yeah.
And so how did you get involved in doing that? So that's like your day job.
Yeah, that's my day job. So training other people, like I got a cool job, man. I mean, I get a chance to go out and do this.
Way cooler than mine.
yeah, it's not bad. You know, it's like Cypress Hill says, you know, it's a fun job. It's still a job. But, yeah, you know, we go out, most of my clientele, probably 80-90% of my clients are law enforcement agencies. Mm-hmm. So I'm out training a lot of cops, but I also train a lot of just ordinary citizens from every field you can imagine that, you know, use a gun for self-defense, whether it's in their home, whether they're concealed carry, whatever they're doing, out there doing their thing. And that's computer programmers, doctors, dentists, lawyers, you know, you name a job, there's a person out there that's concerned. Yeah, it's kind of a universal thing for human beings. They want to be able to defend themselves and their families. And, you know, and people that take that seriously and are responsible about it want to go out and get training. And then, you know, they're seeking out folks like me and a lot of other cats out there that do similar things. So, yeah, my day job is I get paid to shoot stuff and shoot stuff and show people how to shoot stuff and have a good time with it.
No doubt. Yeah, I've seen your Instagram is full of really cool stuff, too. You have so you carry a Glock. And is there a reason you choose Glock over any other makes, or what do you tend to use in your demonstrations when you're actually doing the live shooting with your clients?
Yeah, so I demo with what I really use in that practical application. Mm-hmm. A huge thing I got for all of my training is relevancy. Mm-hmm. I want what I do, the training I do, to be relevant to whatever that is. So if it is, you know, a mom who's concerned about defending her family when she's out doing her thing with her kids, I want her to use the gun and the equipment that she's carrying. I don't want her to play dress up and you know, and there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, there are dudes out there doing that, and you know, training military style tactics and put on all the cool guy gear and go shooting nods and have fun. But I like relevancy. I want them to use their real stuff. So I carry Glocks. I've carried Glocks across my entire law enforcement career, most of my law enforcement career. In the beginning, I had some different options that weren't up to me, but I trust that, and that's what I currently carry now. That's what I use a demo in. Every gun I use whenever I demonstrate in a school or in a class, it's what I use. It's my working guns. I'm not a – call them safe queens. I don't have guns that are just, this looks cool. I want to have this. I want to play this. Yeah. All my stuff I use, so I use it hard, use it till it breaks, and replace it. That's nice. How I roll with it.
Nice. I definitely dig that. I'm the same with almost everything I do, including my music equipment.
Yeah.
it's got to be durable.
Yeah, it's you know, buy right, you know, buy once, cry once. You know, you buy good gear, it's going to last you. And you know, like I carry a Glock, great manufacturer, but there's other good options out there for people. I tell people when they pick the best gun for them, you know, pick the gun that you shoot the best, because a lot of it is about what you're going to be comfortable, confident, what you know you can utilize. You know, pick from a reputable manufacturer. Don't go, you know, if you go out and buy a $125, you know, I don't know, like an old used Jennings or even a High Point. And the Yeet Cannon, Yeet Cannon's got some guns that work, but you buy a High Point, you get what you pay for.
Yeah.
You know, buy quality gear, train with it, learn how to use it, and you're going to have confidence in it. Get something that's big enough for you that you can shoot reliably, mm-hmm. shoot comfortably, I should say, not reliability. Reliability has to be there for you. Mm-hmm. You buy that with quality. You buy that with proper care and maintenance.
Yeah.
But then get what works, get what fits your hand. Everybody's got different hands, man. I used to slide in some of my classes. I don't do a lot of PowerPoint, but mm-hmm. I used to teach more basic classes and had more PowerPoint. I used to slide with a real little, like, 5 foot tall petite female and Shaquille O'Neal putting their handprints side by side. And I'm like, those two, you know, you give them the same gun, it's not going to work. Like, her gun's not going to work for him and mm-hmm. vice versa. So,
yeah, I'll say, like, I used to have a Smith & Wesson M&P shield, and I was using that as my carry pistol. But I was always, like, even after I adjusted the sights.
Number one selling pistol in the country, by the way.
Is it? Oh, that's incredible. It definitely, like, I have a bunch of friends that carry it. Definitely just wasn't for me. It didn't shoot consistently accurate for me. I don't know what it was about it.
So it comes down to the biggest mistake. Yeah. The biggest mistake people make when they buy their first handgun or mm-hmm. they go out and they get a handgun is they get them too small.
Yeah.
So everybody wants to think they got to go really, really small to conceal. It's about proper holster selection, how you dress, mm-hmm. how you carry that gun. But everybody thinks you want to go really, really little. But the really little guns are hard to shoot.
Yeah.
It's just physics, man. I mean, that's all it is. It's surface area. It's the amount of the gun you can actually grip mm-hmm. to be able to exert some control on that. Shorter sight radius bears accuracy a little bit, but mostly it's about the controllability.
Yeah.
And people get too small. Like, they think they want to get something. The way that works, they go into a gun shop and you know, Billy behind the counter asks them if they think they're going to conceal carry. And inevitably, nobody wants to say no. It's like that implied they want to say yes, even though they're not going to really carry it. So then, we're going to take you over here and I'm going to tell you this is what you should get.
Yeah.
And they give these little micro compact or subcompact pistols. Mm-hmm. And people come to classes with them a lot and generally don't have a good training experience because it sucks. It hurts.
Yeah.
The recoil hurts. You know, you shoot 1,000 rounds in 2 days with a little pistol that's pumping some recoil into you.
Yeah.
You know, and then that same Rufus at the gun shop that told you got to buy a 45 because they don't sell a 46. And, you know, your hand's getting pounded up and it's uncomfortable. And all along you'd been good with just a compact or a midsize 9mm price that you need's better than anything else.
Mm-hmm. So how often do you carry, or what's like your recommendation on, like, generally, like, you travel a lot, so, and you're probably, in some crazy neighborhoods going to these different law enforcement.
Sometimes, I mean, it's funny, you get around and I tell a funny story all the time, and as I got older, I got smarter about where I stayed. And when I was younger, I would travel around and I'd look for the cheapest possible deal, which would get me into some pretty shady hotels.
No, I was just in Vegas, picked the cheapest one we could find.
I was in a hotel in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I worked for a company down in Tulsa doing some contract training for them. And I was actually down for their instructor selection training. And I picked a hotel for like $33 a night. And I'm like, oh, this is kick ass. And I rolled in, and as I checked in the lobby, there's a Tulsa PD guy there. And I looked at him. I'm like, hey, are you here for the call? Or are you on a detail? He's like, no, bro. 24/7, we're here all the time. I thought, this is not going to go well. And sure enough, dude, it rolled into the hotel room itself, looked like it'd probably been processed a crime scene three or four times over the last couple of months. And
the one you were sleeping
in? Shaky. Like, it's like five deadbolts in the door. I'm like, all right, cool. The TPD dude was like, hey, you're here with guns. He's like, take them with you everywhere you go. Don't leave them in the room. They'll steal that shit. And I rolled out and I went for instructor selection at 4 a.m. at this hotel. And I stepped out of my hotel room and a dude just... pair of shorts, drenched in sweat, like breathing was loud, like, he looks at me and he's like, yo, man, you ever seen Israeli push-up? And I'm like, he's tweaking and he's spazzed. I'm like, no, dude, I haven't. Guy flops in the ground. Like, he's just, I'm like, I walk away. Like, he's still doing whatever he was doing. And from then on out, I was like, you know what? I'll pay a little bit more and stay a little bit nicer area. But no, dude, back to your original question. I carry guns 24/7, man.
That's awesome.
I carry guns everywhere I go. Mm-hmm. About the only time I get defanged, and I'm pretty fortunate. I have a luxury that most citizens in this country don't have, and that as a prior law enforcement officer, I qualify every year, so I get to carry 50 states, all 50 states.
Oh, that's awesome. So you have like a universal.
Yeah, so I have a universal, which is what everybody should have. It sucks that we don't. We got to jump all these crazy hurdles every time we go state to state. But I carry pretty much everywhere I go. The only time I get defanged are major events, like sporting events. Mm. I pick up like a baseball game or go to an NFL game or something like that. I bounce out and I can't carry them. They don't make any exceptions. Even when I was on the job as a cop, most of those stadiums won't make an exception for you, and they still make you take your gun off, which sucks. But And obviously airports, I, you know, it, it gets locked up. But I fly with guns. I mean, that's stores and luggage and
do my thing. Check baggage. Is it? I just you mentioned the NFL games and stuff. Is it true that they have like snipers at those games?
Yeah, depending on the stadium, there are a lot of team guys that put Overwatch. You know, it's a big, it's tough because it's a big venue and it's a lot of people. Yeah. And you know, even if you put an army of cops, you know, it's still going to be. It sucks because it takes some of your personal protection tools away. I mean, we're never defenseless. You got yourself. You can't, you know, you don't need to rely on a tool. Your best. And I tell people this, and I didn't originate this phrase. And, you know, a lot of trainers say the same thing. A lot of people with experience say the same thing. The most important area in any battle space, if you take a military term, is 6 inches between your ears. Like thinking your way through is going to save you through a lot.
Yeah, but, situational awareness.
Yeah, dude. I mean, there are snipers. They're Overwatch in Overwatch positions. You know, a lot of larger cities where that obviously have NFL teams, except for Green Bay. And by the way, screw Green Bay, go Chicago. except for Green Bay, which is the smallest city that represents an NFL team.
Yeah.
And Green Bay and the cats in Wisconsin are good dudes. You know, they've got big teams and they got guys up there that train. So they train high angle shooting. But yeah, you're being watched. So
yeah, no doubt.
If you get put in an area where you don't get a chance to defend yourself, you're leaving your defense up to the government, and hopefully they're doing a decent job of it. So.
Yeah, absolutely. So, what do you think about some of these, like, some of these movies that have some crazy, like, weapon stuff, like John Wick and stuff like that?
John Wick, man. So, I love John Wick movies, first off. Yeah. Dude, I love them. And the John Wick movies, and Keanu Reeves took his training really, really seriously through all three of them. And he bounced into, when he went from one to two, he trained with some cats that I understand were some former Israeli SF guys and did some weapons training with them. And then when he went into two, he got linked up with a guy named Taron Butler, who Taron is a professional shooter, really, really world-class grandmaster USPSA shooter, phenomenal shooter. And he started training with Taron. There's a lot of videos you see of him, you know, the videos of him in like a desert ranch with all kinds of steel targets. That's Taron's facility. So he trained with Taron and you can watch the tactics and shift. Man, my only gripe with that is, he does something in the first video. He does a technique, and I go nuts on it because it's still out there. But basically, it's the shooting world's equivalent of snake oil. Like, it's called center axis relock, and it's when he puts the gun in front of his face and kind of looks goofy and crazy like that. You know, like the nightclub scene, he does it a lot. That was an old technique that a dude, the guy that invented it, has since passed away. But he had some questionable backgrounds and shaky past. And he sold it as a con snake artist. And most legitimate, reputable guys laugh at it. Mm-hmm. There's only two places you see it. You see it in John Wick, and you see it in Metal Gear, in the video game.
Yeah.
So, yeah, funny. You play Solid Snake, man, he does the same technique. But it's for Hollywood. Yeah.
That's where he has it, like, kind of at a 90-degree angle. Yeah. He's looking up at straight down.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. And right up in his face, looks like a slug.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's what I was saying.
Yeah, man. I unwittingly... I tell this story in my class. I unwittingly trained in that system. I went to a class, advertised something completely different. I rolled in and found out it was this system. And took a two-day class. It was one of the only 2 days of training that were generally worthless. It was good for me to be able to say, no, I've trained in your bullshit, and it is. I don't need to... Like, it was exactly everything I thought. Like, I don't need to go. There's no place for this. It's nonsense.
Yeah.
It's like a lot of things, man. You know, we talked about... It's no different than the martial arts community.
Yeah.
You know, in anywhere... If you want to try to, you know, there's only so many ways to do something. And at this point, you know, there's only so many techniques. You're not reinventing, you know, you're not reinventing a Kimura. You're not reinventing an arm bar. You're not reinventing a draw stroke of a pistol or presenting a rifle. Those have been invented. I mean, those tools have been in combat for hundreds of years. So sometimes dudes that want to sell a product to you will tell you they've invented some new magical
technique.
System.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the best way I can put it, man. So like center axis relock is almost as bad as like the no touch knockout. Like it's bordering that stupid. Like it's really, really asinine. Like everything backwards of what actually works.
Mm-hmm.
Just a dude selling it with a catchy foreign accent. And he's foreign, man. He must know the secret.
Yeah. British special forces.
I tell you what, man. So I talked to, when I took this class, I talked to a cat from that was British SAS.
Nice.
Real deal SAS, was on the Princess Gate, the Iranian embassy hostage siege. guy by the name of Phil Singleton. Mm-hmm. And I called out and sent out emails and texts, and I contacted every trainer I knew, and I said, hey, man, this big agency that's teaching this crap, if you guys got any contacts in it. And I was in the parking lot of my police station, and phone rings, number I didn't recognize. I picked the phone up, and the guy with a British accent.
Oh, wow.
And he's like, hey, you know, this is Phil Singleton. I won't even try to do his accent. And basically told me, yeah, I know that guy. He's a piece of crap. He's a con artist. He never was anything he said he was.
Oh, man.
He's like, that system's complete crap. I says, yeah, I mean, I know that. And he's like, I know some people at that agency. I won't say what agency it was, but I know some people there. I'm going to make some phone calls too and see what we can do. Unfortunately, I still think they teach it to some level, but yeah, dude, I jump on the soapbox every chance I get with that. But it looks awesome. It looks good in the film. So, I mean, I got no problem. So, and to the average person that's out there, they don't know any different. I mean,
yeah, I mean, I didn't even know that. Yeah. So that's news to me. I appreciate you
saying that. It looks cool.
It does.
I mean, it looks badass.
It kind of, you know what it reminded me of? And maybe this is a bullshit thing too, but a friend of mine was showing, he's like one of my range buddies, but he was showing me like a vehicle thing where you look out of this eye, like one eye in the sight.
That's center axis relock.
It is. It's the same thing.
Yeah. It's the same thing. Yeah. So, like, you have a dominant eye. Like, you have a dominant hand. Like, everybody's got right hand, left handed. Mm-hmm. I tell people, think about kickball. You're right foot, left footed, too.
Yeah.
Same way with your eyes. You have a dominant eye. And in the center axis relock system, they tell you to throw all that away. And if you're holding the gun, you use your opposite eye. Like, under stress, like, shit gets stressful. And using things that aren't naturally dominant become that much harder.
Oh, absolutely. But
in their crazy system, you're supposed to think about, you know, it's like, you know, you're learning a new move on the mats and now do it on your opposite side. And all of a sudden you're like, I got this down. I got this down right handed. I go to left handed. I can't do anything.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, be like me and I can't do anything right handed or left handed and be like, I quit. I'm out. I'm tapped. I'm good. But so that system, that's using that opposite eye. The cell for it is good around vehicles, good in close quarters. Mm-hmm. It's not good anywhere. There's actual techniques that work way better.
So, if you're in a vehicle, what's the best way to shoot out of your, you know, driver's
your side? Check this out, man. So the way to do it is the same way in everything else. And it's like anything athletic. Shooting is just an athletic endeavor.
Yeah, absolutely.
It lives in your hips. So your hips lead. So you move at the hips to be able to change positions. Your goal whenever you shoot should be to get to the most consistent position that you normally would work from. Like if I'm punched out and I'm shooting from here, getting my arms as close to that as I possibly can while staying inside the confines of the car. If I got to shoot from inside the car, you know, if I get like a carjacking for a private citizen, I get punched in the back of the head, pushed into my car, and I'm now fighting from that. I'm entangled. Maybe I get the door closed, but they're going to try to break through the window. They're still aggressing. Would be one of the scenarios, but I'm looking to shift my hips, and you can make a lot of movement if you think about it. We don't do it a lot because we don't want to mess our cars up, but you got more than enough room, even in a seatbelt. I do a demo in my vehicle classes where I'll lock in and I'll pull my retractor. You know, I'll catch a retractor like I'm going into it in a crash, or pulling into it real hard, and you've still got 2-3 inches worth of movement and slack in that. And you can move, and it's just about shifting your hips. Just shift to go to wherever you're shooting.
So you're kind of trying to twist
your body.
Yeah, just get your leg out the best you can.
Yeah, that's awesome. Like your driver door. Like you shift your hips, you pull your knee up, put it onto the door, and you can shift your entire way around and spin the whole way.
Nice.
So you just keep your body. You want to hang onto your gun like weapon retention. So you keep two hands on it whenever possible. Keep it inside the confines of the car. Because somebody gets hold of your pistol, if they're outside the car and inside, like. You know, movies tell everybody, you shoot somebody with a gun, they fall down and they die. But reality isn't that, particularly with pistols. And
especially with adrenaline, too.
Yeah, man, you might have to, there's for every documented case of somebody that got shot one time with a pistol, there's 100 documented cases, thousands of documented cases where it took 4, 5, 6, 7, 10, 2 magazines worth.
Yeah, especially with like a 9mm.
Yeah, and it's very rarely. The only way you get that instant shutdown, there's two ways that you get an instant shutdown and a stop of that fight. And one is physiological. The other psychological. So the physiological stop is, you know, you physically stop them. So you hit them in the nerve center, right? You take out their brainstem, you take out enough of their brain, you knock them out, you paralyze them. Real small area of the body, pretty tough to hit. We naturally protect it. The more common is a psychological stop. So you exhibit force against somebody robbing you or attacking you, and they decide you're no longer a soft target, you're not an easy victim, and I'm out. And they bounce, they want to run. So they psychologically choose to stop. Whenever I train people, even though the statistical likelihood is that you'll get a psychological stop, you don't train for that bad guy. You don't train for that person. You train for the person you got to fight with every scrap of you. This is going to keep coming and keep coming, you know, till you feel like you're in Friday the 13th, like literally, like this, you know, this dude won't ever die, but I got to keep fighting every bit I got. That's who you train for. And in that case, you got to hang on to it. And that pistol, that first shot, that first five shots, first 10 shots might not work. You got to keep, you got to be able to keep your weapon and keep putting effective hits. It's no different than anything else, man. It's hits and angles. Every fight in the world is hits and angles.
Definitely.
So,
well, just touching on the psychological piece that you were saying, what do you think about the statistics about how there are way more situations where a lawful gun owning citizen that has like their permit to conceal carry has actually been able to stop a violent crime from occurring versus the amount of actual violent crimes that have, you know, gone through because there was no one there with a weapon to brandish to stop it.
Yeah. Yeah. There's huge statistics that like CDC did some, has some figures that just came out, and even that they acknowledge, and most statisticians and researchers have acknowledged that defensive use of a firearm is wildly unreported. You hear story after story, and I've been in classes and had people come up to me to say, hey, this happened to me and I pulled my gun and I never even called the cops. Like, it doesn't get reported. A lot of these incidents don't. So we'll never know. By the statistics we have, we know that defensive gun uses are, there's a significant number of lawful self-defense uses of firearms across the country every year. We also know that for everyone that's reported, there are probably 2, 3, 4, 5 unknown, untold number of instances where they are. The overwhelming majority, I mean, you take gun crime in general is committed by, the huge percentage of crime is committed by a tiny percentage of the population.
Yeah.
And gun crime is no different. So if you take gun owners as a body, and generally speaking, you got about 100 million gun owners in this country, privately owning well over 300 million firearms, you know, the joke in the gun community is, you know, if we really were a problem, 100 million gun owners, 300 million guns, over a trillion rounds of ammunition, if we really were the problem, you'd know it.
Like, yeah,
like
absolutely.
You'd legit know it. Like, it's not the deal. So, yeah, I mean, I can think to my law enforcement career and people using firearms lawfully, people using firearms unlawfully. And most times folks using firearms unlawfully already were prohibited from owning them, weren't supposed to have the guns in the first place, obtained them illegally, stole them, bought them off the street from stolen or, you know, illegal acquisition of that firearm somehow. The overwhelming majority of folks that own a gun just do it mostly with a big mirror, man. Like, they want it for themselves and their own family. They want it for their safety, for their protection. They're not out to hurt anybody. They're not out to be bad people. They're not out to wave guns and be tough guys and things like that. It's not for protection.
Yeah. So what's your opinion on a lot of these people that are kind of, we have a question or anything? Oh, hey.
CDC, there we go.
Never bothered making public evidence that plenty of Americans innocently defend themselves with guns. Yeah. Yeah, just basically just what you said. And that is on reason.com, though. Is that a reputable source?
For it. Everybody talking about the survey. The study.
What they did was it was kind of
just their article on that CDC thing.
Not jumping crazy on the politics train, but it's interesting, you know, administrations, they run politics. They started commissioning the CDC studies in hopes that the CDC would find gun control through the Obama administration. You know, President Obama was the best gun salesman in the nation's history. That administration, even though he didn't really enact any meaningful legislation, really didn't do anything to impact the Second Amendment while he was in office. But one of the things that they worked on was they started having the CDC look at gun use and gun violence, and the goal to be, if we can't legislate it, let's declare things like national emergencies based on gun violence. And some of the CDC findings were running contrary to particular political opinions. So it got, like that article alluded to, it kind of stayed real quiet. Like, let's not talk about it. There's a great book called...
It doesn't fit our narrative.
Man. Let's not talk about that. You know, there's a great book out, and the author's name totally slips my mind right now, but it's called More Guns, Less Crime. You know, it speaks about the proliferation of firearms. The mere existence of firearms in any section of society doesn't increase crime. In fact, statistically, it's shown that it can decrease, legal firearm ownership can decrease crime significantly in an area. So banning guns and things like that, and taking them away. Because when it comes down to it, gun control and prohibition of objects, in the gun community, if it gets to that, is going to work about as well as it worked of prohibition of alcohol, about as well as it's working in the war on drugs, about as well as it's working. Like, you know, we made, you know, drugs are illegal and they have been for 60, 70 years. So that means there's no drugs out there, right? Like, nobody has drugs. like you can't go get, like, yeah. I don't care. I don't even have to say big city. I can't go down to any corner of any town in America anywhere right now. And in this area, go score heroin, go score fentanyl.
Oh,
go
get, man.
Anywhere and everywhere. Yeah. But it's illegal. Well, if it's illegal, it should be going, it should be away.
Yeah.
You know, the 20s and 30s, a lot of the gun control came out of the 20s and 30s, and the violence came from the 20s and 30s because we tried making this illegal. Like, that didn't work. Like, it's not going to work. And you do the same thing to guns. The only people that are going to have it, you're going to explode the black market for firearms. You're going to make that larger. You're going to drive it into a criminal enterprise where it'll be less controlled than it is now. The whole thing's it's nonsensical. It drives me nuts.
Yeah, it is a mess. I remember having a conversation with Joe actually a while ago about like what happened in Australia, right? Well, like there were statistics showing that there were more burglaries because the burglars knew that the people that own the houses didn't have weapons to protect their houses.
Dude, it's an armed society, it's a polite society. I mean, it's, you know, you talk about complete disarmament of a population. I just saw a couple weeks ago, London's murder rate surpassed New York City's.
Are you serious?
They're killing more people in London. with knife crime. And they want to continue. So the UK, in all their great intentions, still hasn't understood that what they did there didn't do anything. So now they're down to the point where they're criminalizing every form of edge weapon, and it's not going to stop. It's not going to stop the street gangs. It's not going to stop the violence in London. You know, it won't work. Knife control will work as good as gun control has worked.
Yeah.
Sure. You know, long before guns were invented, humans were killing each other.
Absolutely.
And powerful humans were preying on weaker humans and taking their shit. I mean, that is, you know, I don't mean to be pessimistic, but that's humanity, and it has been forever. Like, I'm stronger than you. You can't stop me from taking your shit, so, hey, man, I like that shirt. Give it to me.
Yeah.
And if you resist, then I'm going to use whatever tool I have to see that you can't resist me anymore. Mm-hmm. It hasn't changed. And it's just going to continue to go down that. You can't regulate away. The very first quote you asked me, you can't regulate away evil. You can't. Yeah. Okay, man. Like, every gun law in the world that you want to add to the pile, if every gun law, I've never seen a gun law in the books in the United States, to my knowledge, since I don't even know when, and even in the heyday of the Wild West, I don't think they were.
Yeah.
I've never known of a gun offense to be a capital crime, right? You can't be put to death for a gun offense. But in this state, in many states in this country, you still be put to death for homicide. Mm. So that's illegal. Like, to kill somebody is illegal. So if your deterrent there is, we're going to kill you, we're going to strap you to a chair and stick a chemical in you, or like if you're in Utah, maybe we'll hang you or put you in a firing squad.
Because
Utah still got some rad ways to execute you if they do it.
Using some rad ways.
Yeah, so we'll do that to you. Like that's your deterrent. We'll kill you back.
Mm-hmm.
If you kill, well, then that stupid little misdemeanor or felony slap on the wrist because you then used a gun to do it, or you know, take a state like Jersey has magazine restrictions. You can only have so many rounds in your magazine. Okay, well, you murder.
Hollow points are illegal?
Yeah. Certain types of ammunition are illegal in New Jersey. And okay, so we'll kill you back if you murder somebody. But if we make the type of ammunition you put in your gun, or the 9th or 10th round or the 11th round, depending on the state you're in, make that a felony now. Well, now I've changed my mind, man. I'm not going to do the bad stuff now. I mean, I was going to kill them. I wasn't worried about them lethal injecting me, but now you've thrown on that extra felony for having this. Oh, now I'll stop. Like, what do they think? Like, what's the, it's not, it's people control. It's it's power. It's people control. It's erosion of rights kind of thing. Yeah. So, you know, I came in this, I'm like, man, I'm not going to be political. We're just going to have fun. We talk about stuff. And I'm like, dude, I'm going to end up being political. It happens every time.
Dude, it's the nature of the beast with this topic, man.
It is. It's wild, man. So being in the gun industry, like, I joke around and say, guys, I'm like, I'm pretty Boy Scout. Like, I grew up, you know, good family, good upbringing, loving parents, you know, the whole nine yards. I was literally a Boy Scout.
Yeah.
You know, much to my father's chagrin, I didn't become an Eagle Scout.
Oh, man.
You know, I joined the Marine Corps the day I turned 17. Like, I'm about as apple pie Americana as you can get. Like, I don't really fit any counterculture mold, right?
Yeah.
Except for the gun world. Like, the gun world is this taboo thing. And I realize having been in it my entire life, you know, as a kid growing up around guns, I was into that. But my dad was primarily a hunter. He had some guns he would keep in the house for self-defense, but mm-hmm. primarily hunted, and I was around guns. And then working in the gun industry in one capacity or the other, whether it's military, law enforcement, actually working in the retail gun industry or the training aspects of the gun industry, you realize how kind of counterculture, and unfortunately we're losing a cultural war right now. Like, it's continuing. Each generation, it gets more and more like, oh, you know, guns are scary, they're bad, we got to get rid of them. And people that use them are inherently dangerous or scary or violent or problematic. It's kind of crazy to be that little, you lose a sense of how small of a community is of gun owners.
Yeah.
Tight-knit. And you say that, but there's 100 million
yeah,
gun owners. Yeah. It's a lot of us out there. How active a lot of people are.
Yeah. And most of us have that mentality of the sheepdog protecting the sheep versus the wolves, you know?
Yeah. And I come down to it. I always tell people this, you know, I can't force you to want to protect somebody else. I can't force you to be a protector, to be a cop, to be a sheepdog, to intercede in a violent crime. And no one in the world should force you, but people have the right of self-defense and self-protection. I don't care, man, if you're a pious person, if you're religious and you believe it's God-given, if you're an atheist, don't believe there is a God and just believe it's the natural order of things. And it's, you know, it's evolution has said, you know, survival of the fittest. So for us in modern day fittest, like as animals, we're weak sacks of jelly shit.
Yeah.
Like, we really are, man. We got terrible claws. We got lousy canine teeth. We got bad fangs. Our eyesight's pretty good. Our hearing's okay. Our sense of smell's terrible. Like, our armor and our skin's crap. It's nothing special. We're really smart. So we've developed these amazing tools that let us rule everything. So like that's we've evolved to be able to defend ourselves using those tools. And there's no reason, there's nothing in the natural order of things, the religious side, the personal side, the anything that should take that right away from you. And I think a lot of people, man, that's just what they want to do. I've never wanted to be that person that wanted to rely on anybody else. Like, yeah, it's up absolutely. To me. You know, the phrase gets thrown out is nobody's coming to save us. It's up to us.
Yeah.
Like, it's me. Like, I don't want to be on the phone with 911 waiting for the cops to get to my house to save my family from the gang of three or four dudes that just kicked my front door in at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to grab the rifle I defend my house with. And if I got to fight my way to my kid's room, and you know, they're bigger now. So if they get into their room, I mean, I got one kid at college and one kid home. If they get into his room, he's fighting them too. So,
yeah.
Maybe not. He doesn't have a gun in his room, but he's fighting them. Yeah. They're going to have to deal with him, but I'm going to fight my way to him. And if that's what I got to do, I want that to be my responsibility. Yeah. Not somebody. I'm not looking to outsource my safety.
You're the first response.
Dude, I mean, that's, you're your own first responder. Yeah. Like, you're there. You know, and the fastest response that you're ever going to get as from the cops is still way too slow, man. I mean, if anyone's ever been in any level of fight, not even like a real serious, like, we're going to fight and go at it. It's for real, like, you're going to fight to the death kind of fight. But even just a regular fight, you know, think about that fight. If that fight lasted 10 seconds, that was long.
Yeah.
It lasted 15 seconds. If you had a fight for 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes, which on paper look like great response times. If you go to your township meeting or your town meeting and, you know, your local police chief presents your average department response time is 2 minutes and 48 seconds. You go, man, that's amazing. I live in a great area with great police officers. That's great. And then I tell people, sit and think about that. A dude's trying to kill you and your family. Time out 2 minutes and 48 seconds at best case scenario. Yeah.
And you know what's good a really, luck, man. You know what's a really good way to kind of have an example of that? If you aren't a martial artist or a Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioner, fight a black belt for that long and see how many times you tap. You know?
Yeah. The can I tap? Can I go over under 30 times in the next 6-minute roll that I get tapped? How nice does my professor want to be? Like, does he want to tap me 50 times or not? Does he want to teach me something in this role?
It's just like, I think to bring it to like a relative place, it gives you an understanding of how helpless you might be in a convergent situation like that.
Yeah. And people know, I mean, it's, you don't rise. Everybody's like, oh, man, I'm going to rise to the occasion. I'll just take care of this. And you hear this. It's that street bravado and across everything from a fist fight. You know, one of the things that you know, the guy owns the jiu-jitsu school I train at, he's been coming and training guns with me. And I've got a chance to share the gun training side with him. And he shot before. He was a shooter before. And one of the cool things he got to see was as we work it into, you know, he's a black belt and he's obviously comfortable with violence and comfortable and in a physical fight, he's super chill. You know, he knows his capabilities. He knows his relative You know, you put it in a weapons-based environment, and a comment he made to me early on when we were training, I was like, shit, man, it's like back to being a white belt.
Yeah.
Like, I got to go back to being, not knowing the stuff and seeing that. And training only is going to get you so far. Just like, you know, training on the mats is different than if you get in a real fight. I mean, it's, there are different factors at play.
Well, and generally speaking, your training partner cares about you.
Yeah. It doesn't want to hurt you. They're not looking to hurt you. You know, there's a trust there. You know, you're going to tap, you're going to call it, and it's going to stop. Training in the gun side, you know, if you get to that level, the high enough level, and training like you should, training force on force, where you're training simunition and you're actually shooting each other, and you're seeing it, and force on force training, like shooting at each other and doing that, not with live ammunition, obviously with marking ammunition. That's the gun training world. That's the gun training version of rolling. Mm-hmm. Like, that's where you're going to pressure test a technique. You're going to see it, and you begin to see and see early on there, you know, things that work. You learn real fast what works, what doesn't work. You learn real fast about managing, you know, managing your mental, managing the stress, managing the decisions. Everything you do better fundamentally is less you got to spend brain time working on. More you can think about, like, should I go there? Should I run there? Should I do this? Should I hide behind this? Should I shoot now? Should I not? Can I hit? Can I hit? You got to make all those decisions real quick. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's only a step. That's nothing compared to somebody really trying to take your lunch, like legit trying to do that. That takes the stress, takes the game to a whole nother level.
It's the
best form, but everybody believes, man, and you hear the tough talk and you read comments and in a social media age, you know, my brothers and sisters in blue, when they get involved in scraps and then got to put up with the media, and generally every expert in the world will tell you, don't read shit. Like, you get involved in a shooting, don't read anything, because you're going to go nuts.
Yeah.
You know, and I've read comments in shooting that, you know, real close friends have been involved in. And, you know, you read that and you go, that wasn't how that went down. Yeah, instance that I was involved in, and you know, that's not how that goes. And, you know, nothing's like it seems and nothing's like it's reported, and everybody has an opinion on these things. And it's not like that. So don't read that, man. It's just not, it's not good for you. It's not good for your psyche. And nobody knows. I mean, they don't really know until they've been in that situation. Yeah, it's crazy. So it's wild having been involved and seeing sometimes what gets reported and how things all the way through. I was involved in when I was in the SWAT team I was part of.
Oh, you were on the SWAT
team? Yeah, man. Yeah, that was my favorite thing in law enforcement world, working SWAT. Yeah, I love that. Did that for about almost 13 years out of the 14 I was in. I still stay pretty closely connected with those guys, and I got some irons in the fire to hopefully head back before too long, do that game again. But we were involved in a pretty high profile incident. It was a homicide, and we thought it was a hostage situation. Turned out the guy who had killed the two people and the person we thought he had taken hostage had left the scene willingly together. That's the long story. And they got apprehended a couple days later, halfway across the country. He got sentenced to life in prison for the killing. It was his girlfriend's parents that he had murdered.
Wow.
And it was a pretty big story. It was, you know, it's classic small town America story.
Yeah.
He kills, you know, they were fundamentalist Christian, homeschool, good kids. You know, he ends up killing his 14-year-old girlfriend's parents, taking off with her. You know, she went along with him. We thought it was a kidnapping. They arrest him. High profile enough. It was news for a couple days. I remember it being real surreal. It was November. I think it was November right before Thanksgiving. Sunday morning, just chilling out. Pager goes off. Cell phone goes off. We go. We do the thing. And by the time the whole incident's over and done, I'm sitting back at my house later on that day, and I'm watching helicopter footage of us walking around, clearing scene stuff.
Like, hey,
yeah, I'm like, that's me on CNN. Like, that's right. Right? Because, you know, we're not working in a big first-class city. We don't do that often. And then it got high profile enough that somebody wrote a true crime novel about it.
Wow,
so it's paperback. Yeah. It's Desire Turned Deadly is his paperback. So I had to go buy it and I read it, and I read this book, and reading the book, you wouldn't think, like, I'm like, that wasn't like, did they do any research at all?
Yeah.
Like, that's how crazy. Like, they literally wrote a book. They got a publisher to say, this is cool, man. Do this, write this book. And I question whether or not they spoke to anyone that was involved with the case. They had pictures of the case. They had talked to somebody. But they had so many details so wildly wrong. And you see that even now with any big incident, any of these mass shootings that get reported. The early reporting is just all over the place and crazy wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And people formulate their opinions off those early things.
Yeah.
And shut their brain off. Man, listen, dude, you know, what's the latest pair of you know, jogging shorts and yoga pants Kim Kardashian's wearing. Like, that, their brains, oh, there's a mass shooting over there. Oh, there was like six gunmen. Oh, and they used AR-15 machine guns. That's really fucked up. That's terrible. Oh, what's Kim Kardashian wearing? You know, what's Cardi B doing? Like, they, like, the attention span goes boom, boom.
Absolutely.
And bounces, and they're out. They don't care anymore. And they never get a chance to actually get the real information.
Yeah. All they're basing their opinion on is the headlines, you know.
Headlines, and that's it, man. And if it bleeds, it leads. Like, that's the news cycle, right? Yeah. So, nobody wants to hear a story when you talk about, like, statistics of defensive gun uses. Nobody wants to read about the 72-year-old, you know, retired school teacher who used a firearm to thwart a robbery, a home invasion robbery at her house.
Yeah.
Nobody gets shot. Nothing bad happens. She points a gun at bad guys. They run away. They get arrested 2 days later based on information. That's a stupid story for the news. They don't care. Now, what they'd rather have is a story of, you know, maybe it gets run if she shoots four of them in that. And then, you know, where can we spin that angle and make that horrible? Or she gets murdered. If there's blood, then it's front page. If not, nobody cares.
Yeah. So what do you think about a lot of these crazy articles that come out where there are some, like, negligent firearm uses of actual police officers where they, you know, pull the trigger on someone that maybe was, like, unarmed or something? Mm-hmm. Like, I've actually gone ahead and I've seen some articles where the guy pulls his wallet and it looks like he's brandishing a pistol. Like, why would you pull your wallet out like that?
Dumb.
But at the same time, there's these other ones where, you know, a lot of the, you know, you read into it enough and it's like, oh, man, hey, it's hard to argue your case.
Yeah, and here's why I say this. So I've always, throughout my career, and I train, and like I said, I make my living now training cops. And I'm still in the community, actually getting ready to go back and work a part-time job. The way I explain this to everybody is I got something I call a 10-10-80 rule.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and it's not a unique thought to me. I'm not the first person to say this, come up with this, but 10-10-80 rule says this. So you take any group of people, I don't care what it is, a job, a social group, whatever it is, 10% of those people are awesome. They're great at it. Like, they're the rock stars of the job. They do it. They do it well. 10% complete idiots. Like, they screw everything up. They're who the headlines are made. They're who policies are written about.
Mm-hmm.
And then 80%. Are somewhere, you know, hardworking men and women trying to make a living, provide for their family, do their job to the best of their ability. But that's a big sliding scale.
Mm-hmm.
Law enforcement's got it's down 10%. They're bad cops. I've had bad run-ins with police officers. I've had lousy run-ins where they were unprofessional, they were rude, they escalated situations they didn't need to. I've unfortunately worked with guys that were bad cops. Fortunately, you know, one example I can think of there where, you know, we were able to work him out of the agency, but they're bad cops. Yeah. They're bad cops that make mistakes. I never liked the concept of the blue wall of silence where, man, just because you got a badge and you're behind the big blue wall of silence, like, everything you do is beyond reproach. It's not that. I mean, we should be held to a high standard as a law enforcement officer because of the responsibility of your job. I mean, you got a job that ultimately you're one of few jobs, if not the only job in this country, where you roll in and take people's liberties. Like, I'm going to take your liberty away. I'm going to put you in a box.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you screwed up according to what society says. I'm going to put you in a box. I'm going to put you in a box for a year, 2 years, 10 years, the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm going to take your liberty. I'm going to roll in and if you act in a certain manner and if you're threatening in a certain way and if you fight back, I'm going to punch you in the face and do it with complete legal impunity.
Yeah.
I'm going to shoot you and I'm going to do it with complete. I mean, it's not against the law.
Yeah.
It's lawful defense. And like I said, the overwhelming majority of officers are great men and women. And they really, man, I don't know a single cop. I never worked with a single cop that woke up and was like, I want to get up today and I want to wreck people's civil rights. Like, that'd be really awesome. Like, I can't wait to do that. But it's 10-10-80. I mean, you got guys and gals out there, they're bad at their job.
Yeah.
Just like they're bad doctors. Look at the number of deaths caused by medical malpractice.
Yeah, absolutely. I
mean, they're bad doctors. You know, everybody likes to talk about the person. Everybody likes to talk about the doctor that finished first in his med school. Mm-hmm. No one ever wants to mention the dude who finished last.
Yeah.
Like, there's
with that D-minus. Hey, man,
there's every class, there's one of them, right? And every job in the world, you got bad people at that job. The thing in the law enforcement community is you see it a lot. It's real high profile. And because we got to hold ourselves to that standard, and we should hold ourselves to that standard, it's just a big profile when we do screw up. But it happens, man. I mean, there's no... When we look at that, we as folks inside law enforcement community got to look at that and go, how do we be better?
Yeah.
How do we do this better? How do we train better? How do we equip our officers better through training and education to not do this? How do we lessen the 10%? How do we mitigate them? How do we have hiring practices and retention practices to keep good cops, weed out cops that aren't making it happen. How do we not hire them in the first place if we do make that mistake or it doesn't work out? And then at the end of the day, you know, the other factor is too, cops are human and they screw up.
Yeah, I mean,
you make mistakes, and there's differences between making mistakes, which can have huge consequences, no doubt about that. There's a difference between that, and there's a difference between people that are just generally bad or lazy or apathetic at their job. So you got to make those distinctions. Yeah, I mean, they screw up. I mean, the dirty secret in the whole world is most people have this expectation of the proficiency of their police that is born out of Hollywood. It's born on a soundstage in LA. Man, they believe cops are in foot chases and gunfights every shift, that they can shoot the wings off of a gnat at 50 yards with their pistol. Like, and they're just not that.
Yeah.
And it shocks a lot of people when they get a chance to see it for the first time and go, this is all the better they are. It shocks me as a trainer. Doesn't shock me anymore, but it's something that we got to continually drive and say to them, hey, you got to make this investment. You got to take this interest in your own safety. And honestly, the safety of everybody you work with and the people you protect and serve. You know, this is for your community. You go to the training. Yeah, everybody, every cop in the world and every person in the world that's concerned with self-defense is like, goal number one is I go home and I'm safe. And that's cool. I tell people at the end of every one of my classes, my joke at the end of the class is I got two goals in every single class. Goal number one, I start and finish with the same number of holes in my body. Like, that's legit my goal.
Yeah.
And behind that, like you guys too, like a good safe training. But that's goal number one. And my second goal is you learn something, have some fun. I mean, that's what I say. But cops are the same way. But at the same time, you also got that responsibility. You know, you're potentially a paid gunfighter. People get goofy if you say to them, hey, you know, you're a professional gunfighter. You say it to a cop and nobody wants to be cliche. They're like, that's stupid. And I go, listen, check this out. So if you get involved in a fight, you get involved in a scrap, you use your gun and duty, you're going to get a paycheck for that shift? Well, yeah. I said, so let's run the definitions, man. Your professional means you're paid for your services. You got a gunfight. Now, does that happen? No. I mean, law enforcement shootings run like 3% across every cop's career.
Yeah.
Very, very low percentage. But you're going to get paid for it. Mm-hmm. The hour that you were on a job, you got paid. So welcome to being a professional gunfighter. So, sounds cooler. I mean, maybe a t-shirt or something.
Yeah, but I like that. Yeah, definitely start. Yeah, listen. Start. I'll wear that shirt.
Yeah, bro. For sure.
That's awesome. So, pass me a beer.
Yeah. Which, nonetheless, on that note,
anything is good.
Looks like Golden Monkey.
Yeah, that's good.
Damn, dude, that's 9.5. You can get after it. Yeah, Golden Monkey or Sour after. Monkey.
Oh, the sour. Same percent.
Same percentage, yeah. Man.
This will do.
I thought my German stuff was good. This bad boy.
That was delicious. It was.
Yeah, dude. That's hackers. Yeah. Hacker makes a good fest beer.
No doubt.
I'm a straight up beer snob.
I'll drink to that, man.
Kind of beer. What's you an IPA guy? You on the other side of the spectrum? You like it all?
I'll try anything once. I'm not a big fan of stouts. They fill me up. And
too heavy for you. Yeah.
Just make me want to sleep, you know?
Yeah. I like dark lager. I'm more dark lager side.
Lager's good,
I can dig a stout or a porter, but like you said, they're heavy. I only want to have one or two of them, and I'm like, nah, too much.
You eat that with a burger, you're falling asleep in an hour.
Roll me out in a wheelbarrow. Yeah. Seriously, look at this. Now, let's get back to how we're supposed to do this. You're supposed to ask me questions, not the other way. I'm asking you beer questions. It's ridiculous. I've hijacked this damn thing. Let's get out of here. Come on. Seriously. This is your show. I'll shut up.
Yeah, no, it's all good. So, can you explain to me the Vigr training.
Vigr, yeah, yes. Man. So everybody thinks it's an acronym. What does it mean?
Like, what's
violence in grounded recreation. Now, it doesn't stand for anything.
Yeah.
So the first company I ever had, I started a small law enforcement training company in 2004 called Phalanx Training Group. So Phalanx is an ancient battle formation. Started in 2004, was training cops. You know, it's kind of a funny story there. Like, nobody knew how to spell it right. I thought it was cool because, like, Phalanx is P-H-A-L. My name's Philip, so it's P-H-I-L. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm like, all right, cool. Play on words. I'm getting too geeky and smart for myself. Nobody knew how to.
Jiu-jitsu rash guard.
Dude, yeah. Phalanx, tons of them. Phalanx. Yeah.
So I'm like, man, where do I know that word from?
Yeah, I'm like, Phalanx. I'm like, yeah, cool, man. Phalanx Training Group. It's right before, like, 300 hadn't hit, like, the whole Spartan culture. Everything wasn't huge yet. And, so I was like, yeah, I'll do Phalanx Training Group. I looked it up. I thought I was really cool. Like, nobody knew how to spell it. So finding my website was a pain in the ass. My mom looks at me and straight up was like, you can't call it that. I'm like, why not, mom? She's like, that's another word for a penis. I'm like, mom, that's phallus. Not we're good. I'm like, we're solid. I didn't call it Dick Training Group. Like, we're good. I ran it for a couple of years. I ended up bouncing out working for another company. I closed that down. I was just doing that on the side when I was a cop anyway. And I vowed to myself, like, I'm never going to have a crazy, like, weird name again. Well, fast forward around to last year. I started Vigr June of last year. I was working for a private company here in the mid-state running their firearms and training program. Bounced out of that job. Had a really short window to run up. Sort of knew I was going out on my own, starting out my own company again. So I'm like scrambling, and I'm like, oh, I got to find a name. I got to come up with something. Do I just say, you know, Groff Training Group or Groff Firearms Training? Do I do something with my name, or do I do something catchy? And I'd done a lot of marketing at this other company I worked for, and I'm like, I got to have something. I got to have a name, hopefully something that sticks. So I start digging around. But now the difference between 2004 and 2018, so through all those years of the war, you got hundreds of thousands, millions of guys rotating through overseas, doing their thing, coming back, starting training companies.
Oh, so yeah. Practically, is it that common?
Oh, man. There's you can't swing a dead cat and not hit a tactical training company.
What? Yeah, I did not legit. Know. It was so
there's
common.
A lot of them. There's a bunch of them out there. So I'm web searching, man. I'm Googling around. I'm Google-fooing it. I'm looking for names. I'm trying this. Nope, taking this. Some variant of it's taken. I can't come anything. I'm like, shit. Well, if Spartans were hot back when I started my old company and it was Phalanx, what's hot now? And what's hot now? If Spartans aren't hot, what would you say is hot now?
Right now, we got the John Wick stuff.
John and
Wick's
is solid.
Yeah.
About Vikings. Dude, Vikings are hot, man. Vikings. Yeah, listen, you got Moulin Lave and then Game the Spartans. They were years ago. Yeah. Dude, now Vikings are hot, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So I go to dead language. So Vigr is actually Old Norse. So
nice.
Vigr, V-I-G-R, is Old Norse, and it means able in battle in Old Norse.
Nice.
So I'm digging through dead languages, and I come up with it, and I'm looking at an Old Norse dictionary, and I'm like, cool, man. I'm like, Vigr. I'm like, I'll do that, man. That's legit. So I run it. I Google foo it. Nothing. Like, there's nobody. Like, there's a CrossFit outfit somewhere that's like Vigr CrossFit or something. Like, in, I don't know where they are.
Yeah.
But there's not much out there. I'm like, I'm cool. I'm good.
Yeah.
Register my trade. Register my name. Put all the paperwork in. Start my company. Launch everything. I literally started the company in less than a week. So I had less than a week's notice. Blasted up. Did all my paperwork. Got my thing done. The state was actually fairly easy to do that as a vet. So I always tell people, if you're thinking about military service, man, another great benefit there. They waive fees. They're you got assistance for you if you're a vet. Getting your business started, got that up, got running. Of course, within, I don't know, a day or two of launching, like, my Facebook page, I say, here's the name of my company. My friends knew I was rolling out and doing my own thing. I get a message from one of my buddies. He's like, yo, man, did you Google your name? And I'm having like, oh, shit, like. Yeah, dude, like every variation of the business name, I Googled it. He's like, no, he goes, did you like really look into it? I'm like, why? He's like, go ahead and search it on like your app store. I was like, okay, cool. So I searched on my app store. Well, sure enough, turns out there is in fact a Vigr app, which is it's a hookup app for for different lifestyles. I mean, I'm like, oh, okay, I'm not signing up for it, but I'm like, all right, cool. So it's like some underground, like straight up, like sketchy underground version of Tinder or something.
Oh,
I'm
man.
Like, all right, cool.
It's like, eh,
I'm like, screw
know.
It. I'm like, too late now, man. My company's Vigr. So yeah. So long story short, Vigr is Old Norse for able in battle. So that's where the Vigr comes from.
I dig not that, man.
Yeah, yeah. So that's pretty cool.
I like that a lot.
So I was like, I like Viking. Yeah. I mean, I'm not Viking by heritage, but I'm like, I'm stealing that shit. It's a cool name and it works.
Yeah.
Then I find out after I had Phalanx, now I have Vigr. So now Vigr, everybody's like VIGRTraining.com and doesn't go to my website.
Oh,
and they're like,
what?
I'm like, yeah, it doesn't spell like that. Spell like this. So shows what I learned from my first time. Sometimes a little hard-headed with that. So.
Yeah.
I'm trying, man. I'm browbeating. It's what I say to people, though. And I learned this over training with a bunch of guys all over the country and for years and years. Nobody remembers anybody's business name. Like, I can rattle off the name of some real high-profile trainers and great trainers across the country. And when you're talking to people that have taken training, if you're really lucky, they remember your business name. Nobody remembers that. They go, hey, man, I train with Phil.
Yeah.
You know, nobody knows Pat McNamara. You know, we talk about Joe Rogan podcast.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You never watched one with Pat Mac. It's a great one. Pat McNamara is a former Delta guy.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like Macho Man Savage. Like, he's a freaking beast, like, physical shape-wise. You've never seen a dude. He's in his
real
50s.
Real deal, man.
In his 50s, and he's a freaking brick shit house. Almost nobody knows. You talk to people even in the training industry or active in the training community, be like, you know, do you know, like, any idea what the name of his company is? Like, no, I have no idea. I just know I train with Pat McNamara.
Yeah.
They don't know that, you know, it's T-Max is his company. Nobody knows that. You know, you don't know, you know, they don't know this dude or that dude or their training, their trade names. They just know, hey, I trade with this guy. So I make sure, like, I'll tag stuff and put my name, and I'm always, sometimes I'm like, man, I'm such a, like, a, I feel like a little bit of a marketing whore, like, keep slipping my own personal name into it. Because, you know, military law enforcement, you're taught to be, you know, you're not, and at least in the Marine Corps, you're, you know, not quite this far, but you don't really have a name. Like, your first name is Sergeant and your last name. Yeah. And then you're a Marine. That's all the identity you need. You don't need a specific identity. So in the business side of it, you got to scrub that and be like, you know, no, listen, hey, this is Phill Groff with VIGRTRaining, and I'm teaching, you know, so guys, so they stick and remember the name. It's personal relationships. It's a personal business, a consulting business. You're not going to build business by a name. You're going to build business by giving people a good product that they tell their buddies, hey, man, I got great training from this dude. You should check this out.
Yeah.
It can help keep you safe. So that's the way, I mean, that's how you build. Mm-hmm. That's how you build a real business with it. So.
Yeah. So are you based out of Pennsylvania?
Yeah, man, I'm Central PA. So nice. I'm based out of Lebanon County.
So how many competitors do you have that you know of that also do the same tactical stuff?
Within South Central Pennsylvania, there are at least... just South Central Pennsylvania alone, I'd say there's probably 2 dozen companies.
Wow.
That do it to varying degrees. Yeah, and most of us are, most of the guys are real small, like me. I mean, they're small operations. It's a consulting business. You know, it's have gun, will travel. Like, find out about me. You want me to come to your range? I come to your range. I do my class and do my thing. There's not a, I wouldn't say there's any of the enormous huge names, but even the guys that are the big names in the industry, it's not like a big business elsewhere, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The gun world's much smaller.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's a bunch out there, and there's dudes. I tell people, just vet your trainers real hard. Take a look, you know, see what they say about themselves, see what others say about them.
Mm-hmm.
And the best thing is get a hold of somebody you trust and say, hey, did you train with them? What did you get? You know, what were they? Did they do it low key with no ego? Did they, stay, you know, no ego? They're student first. It's not a come to my class and watch how cool I am and listen to me tell BS war stories. And it's not that class, but really giving you something and value.
Yeah, like, substantial.
Yeah, and I tell people, man, I'm always amazed and I'm always humbled by the fact that people are willing to give me their money. Not only their money, but far more important than their money. Maybe not far more important than their money. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a business. I gotta make a living. But more importantly, honestly, than their money is their time. Like, mm-hmm. you come to me and I'm going to take 2 days. You're going to spend 2 days with me. You know, and those 2 days, you're never getting back.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to pay $400 for that class. You might pay, depending on what kind of class it is, you might have another $300-$400 in ammo. If you're coming from that area, you got hotels, you might have $1,000 investment in this. And that's real money for it's real money for me. It's real money for most people. Yeah. Some folks I train with, it's $1,000. No problem. Mm-hmm. I don't sweat it, but I'm going to take 2 days. What's funny is if it's a person that $1,000 doesn't mean anything for them for 2 days, then those 2 days of their time generally are massively important.
Mm-hmm.
If that person's a professional that's making a great wage, then time becomes their premium. Like, money, I don't care, man. You know, I'm a doctor clearing $450 a year.
Yeah.
A grand for a class is cool, no problem. But that dude might be the only weekend they got free that they don't have this or that or everything else going on. So it's wildly important, and it's really humbling that they're willing to take that time and spend that time with me. You know, just to share, and I tell guys, it's cooperative. Everything's a cooperative learning environment. Like, it's not just what I know or my experiences.
Yeah.
It is that, but more importantly, pulled up from everybody that I've trained with and everybody that comes in class and brings us different life experiences.
Mm-hmm. So you said like 80 or 90% of it, the classes that you do are actually for law enforcement,
yep.
But for those like other 10 or 20%, those are like private sessions that you do?
Yeah, yeah.
Do the ranges contact you and say, hey, we want to run this? Or
usually it's an individual.
Okay.
So it's just an individual who says, hey, I have this range here I go to. We can train here. I'd like to host you to come out for this class. Sign up. And then I call them open enrollment. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you can still have, I mean, cops can still enroll in the class, but I gear open enrollment classes at private citizens. Like, it's a different... It's my class, even when they're the same, like my armed vehicle defense class, which is my number one. You talk about shooting out of cars and shooting through cars and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. That's my AVD class, my armed vehicle defense. I have two versions of that. They're wildly different. You know, the law enforcement one's specifically for cops. The open enrollment one is specifically for concealed carriers and carrying their gun. Totally different mission set, different parameters, different everything, different relevance, different whys to why you would do that. But yeah, I'll just get a guy who call me up and be like, hey, I want to do this. I want to host this class. Can you come up here? Can you come over here? Can you come to this range? And then we sign it up. So I take care of getting them up, and then we put out the word. Put out emails, put it on social media.
Nice.
They spread the word and we get folks into it.
Cool. So like they'll advertise that, hey, we have Phill Groff coming to our range and he's running this class.
Yeah.
So how can people reach out to you and maybe get their, you know, gigs at their range with you?
Yeah. So the easiest way to catch me is just go to my website. Mm-hmm. And all my contact info on there, it's info@VIGRTraining is my email. Is the primary email to get a hold of us. The phone numbers are listed on there. I'm on Instagram and Facebook as VIGRTraining.
Mm-hmm.
You can bounce me, DM me through either of those, and any way you can catch it. I'll tell the dirty secret right now, and the dirty secret is this. You know, whenever I'm in class and I talk and I say we, like I'll refer to VIGRTraining, like, you know, we are going to come to your, we are going to do this, and we and my team, or blah, blah. It's me, man. So that phone number on there, that's me. That's my phone number. That email, that comes to me. It's me, and it's cool, and I like that. I get to control. I can control mm-hmm. every aspect of it.
Yeah.
I can control the quality, control what I put out as far as content. But it's me. So you want to get a hold of me? Yeah, you bounce my website, VIGRTraining.com, no R in Vigr,
mm-hmm.
and they can get everything they need there.
Okay. So do you ever do like private lessons?
I do. Or yeah.
Just like one on one.
I do. Yep. I offer private lessons, and I get a pretty fair amount of folks that train with me in private. Private lessons versus a group setting, like anything else, it's a little bit more money. But at the same time, it's a lot more efficient.
Yeah.
So for the same price, you get done training a couple sessions, you might get it to work out. And some people are more comfortable in that. Generally, in my private training sessions, with a couple exceptions, most of my private tend to focus on the lower level, the more introductory level. The I'm just getting a gun. I want to know how to be mm-hmm. safe in this.
I want
safe
ownership. Yeah, I want an expert to show me.
Yeah, I want somebody to show me. I want to get good training. And most of my private training clients, that time thing, again, is the massive. Like, that's what's important to them. Their time's important and the flexibility and scheduling.
Yeah.
So, hey, yeah, look, there he is. There's that cat. Look at
cool,
that.
Cool, man. Yeah, man. That armed vehicle training. I definitely.
Yeah. Vehicles are a trip, dude.
I wanna see it.
So better than you gotta check it out, man. So sure. Vehicles are for law enforcement. Better than 2/3 of all lethal force encounters that cops face
mm-hmm.
are in and around cars.
Yeah.
For private citizens outside the home, there's no real statistical database that says this number is around cars or this number is around vehicles. But we know just based purely on the amount of times we're in and around cars, you can look at carjacking stats. Even beyond carjacking stats, you look at any violent interpersonal crime, if it's not home-based or business-based, meaning it's not in your place of employment, somewhere you're at, the chances of you being in or in super close proximity to a car are very, very high.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you're going to be around a car, and all you got to do is see, you know, surveillance cam footage from robberies and attacks and things like that to see how often. And there's a huge amount of misinformation out there, you know, across the entire sector, across police and private citizens, about what happens around vehicles. How do we react around them? What are some common patterns of movement? What are the cars stop? You know, you talk about what's the car going to stop? You know, like what on the car is going to stop a bullet?
Yeah.
And where and how does that work? And how does the human psyche in a fight work around that? You know, what are bad guys' predictable behavior patterns that we can try to counter? What are they going to do? How are they going to move? How are they going to attack us so we can prepare to stop it from happening? If it does happen, how do we mitigate it? So it's a lot of stuff going on. Plus, at the end of the day, all the serious stuff aside,
mm-hmm.
like, it's a freaking blast to shoot out of a car. Like, I strap you in the car, you're buttoned up in a windshield, and you're going to blast it. You're going to shoot a car. Fun. I mean, it's going to, we do something at the end of both my classes, both my open enrollment and my LEO class. I do something called secondary ballistics lab. Day one, I do a whole ballistics lab. And what that means is I shoot the car all over the place. Like, we put hundreds of rounds into the car in different areas to see what stops bullets, what goes through, what doesn't go through. Man, we blast the car to pieces. The last thing we do in both classes, live fire, is we put a car down range, we just open it up, let you go nuts on it, shoot anything you want on it, blow it away,
awesome.
blast it up, shoot it up, and then we go up and look and see if there's any like weird anomalies, like
mm-hmm.
this stopped or this didn't.
Yeah, like this ricocheted and caused
this bounced here, this did this crazy thing. Plus people are just like, man, this is cool.
Yeah,
like I just want to go out and shoot it.
Where do you get the car? How do you, what's
yeah,
the situation
so,
with that? You go to like a junkyard?
Yeah, you just contact your salvage. So any of these salvage, any wrecker companies got cars laying around that they're getting ready to scrap. And as long as they have glass in them and seats for me, and we can push them so we can rip the linkage out or put them in neutral and steer them. We'll push them around the range and we'll shoot them up. And most of the wrecking companies love it because they come in, we shoot the car. Usually you got to pay, like for private, cops can usually twist their arm, not twist their arm, but cops can sweet talk them and get them for free. For my nice. My private classes, usually I pay maybe $100-$200 a car or something like that.
Oh, wow, nice.
That's for them to drop it off, and then they pick it up, and everybody I've ever talked to is like, man, this is the greatest thing ever, because they put them onto the flatbeds, and they got literally thousands of bullet holes in them.
Oh, yeah.
Like the Swiss cheese. Put them on the flatbeds and roll out with them, and dude's like, the looks we get rolling. Like, and every tow truck driver is always like, they'll roll up and
they'll
and
just tell stories like, oh,
dude,
man,
they tell stories like, yeah, oh, yeah, man. You know, insert whatever small town, like here, like they'd be like, oh, yeah, we got that from this part of Reading, and that was on this street in Reading, and like, yeah. Laugh. But a lot of the tow truck guys are like, they'll roll up and they'll be like, can I shoot the car? Like, yeah. Yeah, you can shoot the car, yeah, cool, sure, dude. Right, knock yourself out. I'll shoot with a machine gun. Here you go, dude.
Yeah, it's like, you're gonna knock like half off that toe.
Yeah, I've done that already. I'd be like, yeah, I mean, like, hey, or I'll sweeten the pot. I'll be like, hey, man, I appreciate you doing this. Appreciate your toe. And so here you go, dude. You can shoot this. Here's a machine gun. Shoot the car. And it's like if shooting a gun that you've never shot before is fun, if getting to shoot something that you're never allowed to shoot. I mean, how many people, you know, you take your average gun owner and say, hey, man, have you ever shot a car? And 99% of them are going to go, no. And 1% is going to go, this one time I was putting my gun in my holster. And be like, yeah, I did, but I didn't want to. But you take a class like this, I'm like, yeah, you're going to shoot out of, you can shoot into, you're going to shoot around, you're going to let it rip, man.
That's awesome.
It's a ton of fun. It's my most popular class. Mm-hmm. It's my favorite to teach. It's a ton of, it's a ton of good information, but it's a blast. It makes teaching a class like that a layup, because I know people are going to have fun no matter what.
How many people are usually in a class?
So my average open enrollment classes right now are probably, depending on what it is, anywhere between 6 and 10. So relatively small class.
That's nice.
Size. Yeah,
I wouldn't want a class of 30 dudes. That would be ridiculous.
My cop classes get bigger. I mean, I taught a class in Doylestown this week, last week. It was 26. So, mm-hmm. I mean, it's not uncommon for me to teach full classes there. At like
20, with a lot of cops,
24
of
officers.
Course,
yeah. And we're rotating through. So they're usually generally a little bit bigger, but mm-hmm. open enrollment 6 to 10 mm-hmm. is usually about where it's at. So, I'm hoping to pick that up, but I probably will never go above probably 16 to 18 is where it's going to tap off.
Yeah. That's a nice sweet spot.
Yeah. You go much bigger
like
than that.
10 and 15.
And I've been to classes like, I mean, I've been to classes where dudes were, I've been to classes where there've been 40 guys and they got 5 or 6 instructors. And mm-hmm. if they're all engaged and switched on and good dudes, you got one main voice giving you the technique, giving you the drills, and you got a bunch of guys watching. You got personal interaction in that skill. I've been to classes where it's been 40 people and one dude sitting in the middle of the range, calling drills, giving no personal feedback. You know, I can watch YouTube and see drills to shoot. That's not what I go pay money to go to a class. I've been to classes where it's in between there. You know, it's 12, 16, 20 guys. If an instructor's good and knows what he's doing, a lot of people get freaked out and be like, oh, it's 20 students and one instructor. I'm not going to go to that class. It's going to suck. If the instructor's on point and knows what they're doing and is really, really good, they can handle that and belt that out. No problem. Yeah. I took a class. I still train too. I mean, I go to classes, I shoot competition. I go to training myself.
Well, you said important. You shoot competition. Mm-hmm. What do you do? 3-gun?
No, I dabbled in 3-gun for a little bit and bounced out and I roll back now.
Dude,
you got to do
it,
man. It's a blast. The easiest thing is just get your guns and go do it. Like don't expect to do anything crazy. Now I'm roll back just shooting pistol, shooting USPSA. I used to shoot IDPA. I don't really do that too much anymore. The rules and the nonsense in that league kind of got a little bit too much. And to say I shoot competitions not much, this year hasn't been real, real good for me. I don't get a chance to do it as much as I used to, or as much as I'd like to. But whenever I get a chance, I roll out and shoot a match and have a blast with it and go to training. But yeah, you can handle it. I mean, good instructors will personalize drills, will run things in a way that will get a lot done and get you your money's worth.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So let's talk about weapons a little bit.
Yeah, man.
What's the coolest gun you've ever shot?
Coolest gun I've ever shot.
Like your favorite.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, it's obviously a relative question.
I'm wrecking the mic, man.
Yeah, sorry, man.
Hot mic, hot mic.
It's been through some things.
I don't want to know, dude. I'm on a bus. Things happen. .com. I don't want to think about it. But you got plastic on the seat?
No, yeah, something good. Like that.
So my favorites, I'd have to say, so pistol wise.
Top three.
Categories. Categories. Yeah, yeah. Pistol, man, I'm a Glock guy. So I dig my Glock 34s. I got a couple of them. Now I've transitioned. I got a couple of dot guns. Glocks, I'd have to say, although Glock 18, the full auto machine pistol Glocks.
What?
They're rad, man. They're awesome.
You would know, probably.
Oh, dude, they're great, man. I was teaching a class in Louisiana this year, and some Louisiana State Department of Corrections guys were running full auto Glocks, and I was like, hey, let me run a demo of that. It's on my IG channel, one of my pages. It's just me burst firing, doing a demo that normally do some auto, just let it rip, dude. What I didn't show is a video of me warming up that, because every time I shoot a full auto machine pistol like that, I warm up first to get myself reacclimated to the recoil, because they'll run on you.
No doubt.
And I was like, whoop. And my last round hit like 2 or 3 feet below the top of the berm. I'm like, that's why I warm up. But yeah, I'd say Glock 18 is the most fun to shoot. That's a blast. It's silly and it's ignorant. It doesn't have a lot of practical application, but man, it's fun.
What magazine was in it when you were shooting it?
I was just shooting standard capacity. So I'm literally like changing like 13 mag. Rounds, and you can see in the drill, round. I was running 17 round, 20 round extended mags. Millimeter. I think I was running mostly 20 round mags. And I'm changing every couple seconds because I'm just burst on 2 or 3 targets. I'm changing mags. I'm out. Off I go. So let's see, man. So I'd have to say that my favorite long gun of all time, I'm going to throw back retro, back to my Marine Corps days, and say MP5.
Nice.
So, dude, MP5 is just it's a Cadillac of submachine guns. It's just awesome, dude. And it's just fun. It doesn't have, and I don't run an MP anymore. I ran an MP when I was first a SWAT guy. Short barrel AR-15s are kind of where it's at. That's what I use as my home defense gun. So I run a little Mark 18 SBR as my primary home defense gun. And that's my main teaching gun. And I run that a lot.
What's the make?
I run a Noveski. So yeah.
I know that one.
Yeah, Noveski. Yeah, so I'm telling you, man, buy quality. So Noveski's a pretty good rifle manufacturer. A lot of good rifle manufacturers out there. So I run a Noveski. They're pretty solid. Machine guns. Dude, it's hard to beat a Ma Deuce, man, a 50 cal.
Oh, yeah, 50, for sure, dude. It's hard to beat
that. We're going to go up to machine guns, but I don't have one of those anymore. I wouldn't want to pay for the ammo for one of those, but they're a blast, too. So.
You ever shoot a Mark 19?
I have. They're awesome, too.
That's my favorite.
Yeah, they're awesome, too. Dude, so, yeah, man, I was real fortunate. The unit I was in the Marine Corps, we had every weapon system available in the Marine Corps, and guys in the platoon, we trained on all of them. So we trained on every system they had. So we got to shoot everything. We got to shoot a ton while I was at that unit.
What MOS were you?
So I was, which one? My primary was just a grunt. I was an 0311 as my primary.
Nice.
Then I was also an 8152, 8154, and 8563, I think it is. So I was a basic Marine security guard, which is security force battalion.
Mm-hmm.
Then 8154 is close quarters battle team member. So I was in fast company.
Nice.
In an anti-terrorism unit. And then the final one is a Marine Combat Instructor Water Survival.
What?
Yeah, so you pitch me in the drink, I'm good. So I joke around, I'm like, hey, man, you need me to take down a ship, and then if you fall in, I got you covered both sides. Like, I got you.
Nice.
I got you handled both ways. But, so we shot everything, dude. We shot mortars. We shot SMAWs. We shot rockets, mortars. Every machine gun, Mark 19s, Modus, 240s, 249s. All the machine guns we had, all the shoulder fired, M4s, M16s, MP5s at the time. That was our primary CQB
I've never
gun.
Shot an MP5.
Dude, they're so jealous. Fun, man. So fun. They're a blast. And they really, really, I mean, they're a fine piece of German engineering.
No doubt. So actually, let me kind of back up here quick. So at your class, do you bring any weapons that people can use, or do they need to bring their own equipment?
Most times they bring their own, but you contact me, you can give me a shout if you need a loaner. I guess next weekend coming up, I'm teaching a rifle class, and I got a guy taking the class that needs a rifle. He doesn't have one yet. He's still deciding what to buy. So I'm going to hook him up. I've done some private training. Well, I've done a lot of private training with him. He's a regular training partner of mine. He comes and trains with me quite a bit. He's going to take his first rifle class. I'm going to loan him a rifle for that. So with the exception of any force on force, like the simunition guns, if it's a sim gun, if it's law enforcement, I ask him if they got them, bring them. If not, open enrollment, nobody's got their own sim guns.
Yeah.
So I provide those. I bring those.
Do you have any unconventional or like automatic weapons that you have? Like,
no, I've got no machine guns. Mm-hmm. They're just too expensive. I mean, they're... You know, they're a great, if you got the cash, they're a great investment.
Yeah, you got to have that stamp, too.
Vehicle. Yeah, dude. I do have SBRs. I mean, I've got a short barrel and I got suppressors. I got two suppressors getting ready to go into suppressor jail, and hopefully the NFA branch at ATF isn't too brutal with me, and I get them within a couple of months, but get a couple more cans coming in. So I have put up with that silliness.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no full auto.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's cool though.
Yeah, I mean, I still have access and some local, some guys with some FFLs that I know and a bunch of agencies. Usually I get a chance to shoot other people's machine guns now.
Yeah.
Which is perfect because I go to class and dudes will have select fire rifles or sub guns or machine pistols. And I'm like, hey, let me shoot that. And I shoot it and I hand it back to them and they clean it. Yeah. So that was the worst part about anything machine gun. I'd be like, I'm going to shoot it and I'm like, man, I'm going to have like an hour of fun. Or 30 seconds of fun if it's like just a fam fire, and then my entire platoon is going to clean for the next 3 days at the armory.
Nice.
Now I'm just like, hey man, that was awesome. Yeah. That's rad, dude. Enjoy that. I enjoyed that. You clean that up. And I'll shoot their ammo too, be like, oh, it's in your magazine, man. I got to shoot it. Okay. Hey, that was fun, dude. Rock on. Appreciate it.
Nice. That's awesome. So we did pistol, rifle.
I went pistol, rifle, machine gun. Man. Yeah, yeah. I jumped in.
So let's, I guess, end with shotgun.
Shotguns, yeah. So I get accused. I did a video for the video. The company took it's gone now. It's not there. But I did a video that got a lot of traction called "Shotguns Suck for Home Defense," and that made people lose their minds, and go crazy. Yeah, man. So I get accused of not being a shotgun guy. I'm not a huge fan of shotgun for at least for law enforcement for personal protection.
Do you hunt at all?
I used to, man. Mm-hmm. I used to love hunting, and then I got out and. I got too many other hobbies and I lost
time.
Crazy. It was time in this state. I don't know if it's laziness, but you got to hustle a hell of a lot harder. Like I remember being a kid. I went from when I turned 12 and could hunt to the day I left from the Marine Corps. I shot at least a deer in every season, if not two in every season there.
That's crazy.
I went in the Marine Corps, got out of the Marine Corps, and I'd hunt for years and not see a tail. Like I'm like, what? This sucks, man. So I was like, I used to know how to do this. And I'm hunting the same spots and things are different now. No, I mean, I love shotguns for specialty delivery. Like you can do the versatility of a shotgun is astonishing. You can do everything with a shotgun. If I had to pick one gun, like zombies are coming, that's for real. It's the zombie gun in the world. And I have all the ammunition in the world I can get my hands on. A 12-gauge pump action shotgun is going to get you the most because you can do everything in the world with it. Mm-hmm. I can hunt with it. I can protect with it. Capacity sucks, ease of use is so. They're harder to shoot than an AR. A lot harder to shoot at speed. Capacity is lower, range is much lower, but versatility is off the charts. I can do everything with it. I mean, I can shoot big animals, little animals, people, zombies. Mm-hmm. Like I can do it all. I can breach doors, I can shoot impact munitions, I can shoot gas, and I can do everything in the world with a shotgun. So I have Benelli. The Benelli Nova pump I run right now. Yeah, the Novas aren't too bad. They're decent. And I've got a couple of Remington 870s. So I've got some breaching shotguns set up like that, little shorties. So
nice. Yeah. What do you think? I can't remember what the model or the make of this is, but it's like it's got a revolving... It's got four tubes that revolve. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, there's a couple.
It's like a 412 or something.
What is the one that spins? I'm trying to think of the name brand of it now. They do have some ones that are revolving tube. Mm-hmm. You've got dual tube like Kel-Tec KSGs, which are dual tube pump action shotguns, so it's running two feeding tubes. So you got KSGs which are pretty cool. I'm drawing a blank on that too now.
Yeah, you ever watch FPS Rush on YouTube? Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Like he had like the dragon's breath here, the bird shot, and then the buck shot. He was just shooting all sorts.
DPS
of
DPS is another double barrel, double tube gun that's wild that you can shoot.
Crazy stuff.
And you can put some gnarly looking muzzle device on them, like big spikes. So they're pretty cool too.
That's awesome.
Yeah, they kick like a mule. I shot them. They pound you. So do the KSGs, the Kel-Tec KSGs.
Nice.
Thump. They thump. You shoot slugs out of them bad boys. Yeah, they thump. They thump.
So, let me give you a scenario, right? I'll give you your zombie apocalypse
zombie
scenario.
Zombies are real!
So, all right. So you have your carry pistol, right?
Yep.
You walk up, and there's zombies everywhere, and there's a car here, and it's got a trunk. It's got your rifle of choice, your melee weapon of choice, and another special item. What are those three things? This magical trunk of this car. You open it, and that's going to get you through.
Magical trunk of my car.
It's going to get you back to your house to get to your family.
Yeah. So my rifle, probably be my shorty suppressed.
You can have any weapon.
Probably running a Mark 18 suppressed, a couple drum magazines. I'm ready to rock and roll there. Quiet it down a little bit. My melee weapon, believe it or not, I thought about this quite a lot for zombies.
My man.
Dude, I would want some type of a pole spike. Like I'm always like, why are they screwing with like katanas and axes and dude,
the baseball bat with the barbed
wire. Tomahawks, man, I love tomahawks, but why would I get that close, man? I just need something like a 4 or 5 foot pole with a spike on it. So if you call that a melee, if not, I think I'm gonna have to roll Last of the Mohican style, and I'm rocking a tomahawk because I just dig tomahawks.
You good at throwing them?
You know what's funny is I just throwing tomahawks this afternoon. I should have got a video. I was over at my brother's place having a barbecue.
That's awesome.
He's got a tomahawk stand and 6 tomahawks. We're out there chucking hawks and doing our thing for his. He has a Meatapalooza. I'm like, dude, you got to change the name of that.
Meatapalooza.
Dude, he's got a smoker and he smokes a whole bunch of meat. And he's like, yeah, it's Meatapalooza. I'm like,
Called something else, bro.
I'm like, dude, something different than Meatapalooza, man. I'm like, I don't know, dude. You're a married man. That's weird. But that shit's good. Me at brisket, all kinds of really good stuff. But yeah, I'm okay and I'm fair. I'm better at shooting than I am at throwing tomahawks. But it's a blast, dude. And it's
you ever throw like axes at those?
I have. Yeah. So here's my favorite thing about that, right? So I worked for a company for about 4.5 years. We had a big indoor range. And obviously at a big indoor range like that, if you even like looked or smelled like alcohol, we're like, hey, man, sorry, you can't play. Like, no pay to play. You go to an axe bar, and most of the axe bars in the areas are encouraging you. And the first time I went to an axe bar, it was an axe bar and a, well, it was an axe bar and a meadery. So they had mead. Oh, like, you want to talk about Vikings? Like, we're rocking our mead. And you walk up to do your axe throwing, and the guy's like, you got a drink? Like, you got to have a drink. And I'm like, so you're going to give me axes and actively encourage me to get hammered while I'm throwing axes. And I laughed because, like, every employee in the place, my favorite part is, like, you sign your waiver, you go to the bar, and, like, every employee's like, you don't have open-toed shoes, do you? Like, they're all looking to make sure I don't have flip-flops on. And I'm like, no, dude, I don't have open-toed shoes on. So we're really super worried about open-toed shoes, but, like, get fucking hammered while you throw axes. Like, where's the balance here? Like, yeah, get drunk and throw axes, but, dude, don't do it in flip-flops, or that's, like, too far. Now you're being dangerous and stupid.
Dude, I went one time, and they bounce back.
Oh, shit, yeah. You gotta watch, man. They'll hit you.
Yeah. So you said your personal rifle. You said
my personal rifle
and a tomahawk.
Yeah. If I had to go with the melees, if I had to throw a pistol into the max, I'll tell you what I would do. I'd do a little suppressed 22.
Because they're
super quiet, man. Super quiet.
Like a Ruger 10/22.
Tick tick tick.
Oh, just little, a pistol one.
Yeah, just a little pistol, like a Ruger Mark IV suppressed. Real quiet, just tick tick tick. Nobody hears a thing. Yeah. So.
With that.
Depends. Are these dumb slow zombies? Are these smart running zombies? What do we got?
I don't know, man. Probably it's a mix of both.
A wide spectrum in the zombie genre. I mean, are we talking Walking Dead or are we talking I Am Legend? I mean, what kind of zombies we got?
That's awesome.
Might change it.
You ever see that movie, The Crazies?
Crazies? No, I don't think I have.
Oh, okay. So, like, I Am Legend was like a virus caused them to become, you know, like zombified. But in The Crazies, it was a chemical thing.
Okay.
And it was like almost like a drug thing. But, they could still infect each other. It was crazy. That's a great movie.
Check it out, man.
Yeah. It was like a weird movie. Like, I don't know how I ended up. It was probably on FX or something. But I was like, oh, my God. I watched it like 10 times after
FX
that.
At 3 in the morning. Yeah. You just picked up some Chinese. And you're like, all right. Leftover lo mein. And be like, all right, I'll watch this. Yeah. It's all good.
Let's see. No, that's awesome. So, all right, cool, man. Do you wanna crack out some of your toys?
I mean, I know what they look like. You want me to crack out some toys?
I do want you to crack out the toys.
Let's go grab some toys.
So, oh, shit, your beers are over there, too. Swing me one of those. Swing me one of those Bammer Jams. Thank you, sir. I'll wait till you bring out your coin, too. We could probably show that on camera. That thing's
fantastic. Yeah, it's pretty rad, man. I tell you, their challenge coin. So I train with...
I'll hold it, yeah.
Yeah, with Ben Salem SWAT. Their challenge coin game is strong. So not only is it a challenge coin, it's also a bottle opener.
Yeah, that thing's awesome. So you said it's a challenge coin. What did you have to do to earn this bad boy?
I had to be a rad instructor. Yo, give me some stuff and I'll give you a t-shirt.
That's awesome.
So I brought my guitar case to sing you the song of my people.
Oh, my man.
Makes getting in and out of hotels. So I brought two of my toys along just to show. It's like show and tell when you're a kid.
Yeah.
So I brought two toys along. Because politicians this week were talking about taking away your AR-15s and your AK-47s. I believe Robert Francis said, hell yes, we're going to take your AR-15 and your AK. So I brought one of each.
My man. That's fantastic.
Woo, that was a catch.
That was a good catch. Well, this looks like you bought a guitar case that is designed to
It's designed for you. This is Hazard 4. It's coming out of California. Nice. This is their battle axe case.
I like that, because I'm like, this is not what a guitar case
no,
is.
No. It's purpose designed, and if you look, like, the front
pouches. That's amazing.
So you break in. This isn't like your little mini amps or your picks or anything.
Yeah.
It's all set up for magazines.
That's fantastic.
Actually, there's pistols in there, too. I brought some.
Oh, man. All the toys.
Got some toys.
So you said there's like mag slots.
Yeah, you got your mag pouches and everything. Yeah, your cleaning kits and everything. It's purposely designed for.
I kind of want to just like take a peek.
Yeah, I do. There's like, that's swag. Oh, you want some hair wax, man? Lox hair wax.
Oh, yeah.
You need hair wax, too. You need hair wax. Tattoo brightener.
I'm losing the hair.
TA Targets. Go for it, man. Have at it.
Oh, sweet. For real?
Everything. Yeah, for real.
That's awesome, man. I'll throw that on my guitar
case. There's some hair wax for you.
Oh, sweet. Thank you, sir.
And some wristbands.
Let me get another sticker. I'll throw another sticker on my guitar case.
Throw as many as you want. Listen.
My man. Oh, you have two different stickers.
I got lots.
Put the other sticker up here.
These cats. So, Lox, this isn't mine, but you throw it up there, dude. Lox are good cats. So he's an Air Force.
I definitely will.
He's in the Air Force Reserves now, I guess. Air Force vet, was a state corrections officer, and started cooking hair wax, his own non-water based hair wax, and figured out he digged that more than he digged wading in human filth at the prison. So he's doing his thing, man. That's another Pennsylvania based company.
That's awesome.
I'll definitely
throw that sticker up there.
Yeah, they do cool stuff. They do some great marketing, and they make a good product.
I thought that was your shirt.
No, this is real similar, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, cool. Skulls and Vikings
yeah,
and stuff.
Yeah, all that good stuff, man.
So,
may I?
Yeah, dude. Let me clear them out for you, double check them.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I know they're empty, but we'll double check the firearm safety first.
Of course. All right. Ooh, man, you have a special trigger on this guy.
Oh, yeah, that's a Velocity trigger, Velocity Precisions MPX. Yeah, it's a beast there.
Man, look at this strap. Is that
coming? Yeah, so if you pop this up, yeah, so roll up here. So grab that tab, right? Like, this is called a Bubba tab. It's another. Hey, man, I'm going to hawk PA companies all day long. Lunar Concepts.
Awesome, man.
So great dudes. Oh. So then that's
a 1 point.
Yeah, that's run a 1 point. I run all 1 point convertibles, so I can run them in 1 point or 2 point configuration.
Oh, I like this little guy up here.
Ooh. Yeah, hit your bad lever, close your slot. Yeah, you're rocking it.
Is that this thing?
Yeah, that's that thing.
What?
So hit that, put that.
That is like a hairpin thing.
So don't even keep your right hand on the firing control group. So we're going to go back to basic camp, back to boot camp. So run there and just put upward pressure here.
Now you can upward pressure.
Yeah, now you can lock the bolt.
That thing's a hairpin.
And release your bolt now on a reload. So mag goes in, boom, hit that, reload. Way faster than having to reach up and hit the button.
My God.
Some guys love them. Some guys hate them. I love them.
Yeah, that thing was quick. I mean, getting used to that probably would not take that long. Because, like you were saying, you're keeping your hand on the control group here.
Yeah, it's training.
Man. This is your guy.
That's
my
go-to. Yeah, that's my go-to.
And you have the CCO on there. Man, that is very nice. That is very nice, Phil. What do you got going on here on the
just extra
system?
Just nice extra feel good.
All right, nice extra feel good.
Extra feel good. Yeah, it was LaRue clips, man. Nice extra feel good. Plus, it gets hot. More plastic material you put in there when you start running that gun hard, it gets hot.
No doubt. So, can you describe what's going on with the suppressor here?
Yeah, so that's an AAC mount. Actually, I'm switching out. I'm getting ready to a company in Massachusetts I'm going to be working with called Da Vinci Arms is running their cans. So, I'm getting ready to swap that out, waiting on that Da Vinci to come out of suppressor jail, but that's not there's not a suppressor on it now. That's just the quick mount for an AAC, for one of the AAC cans.
So this doesn't suppress the flash
I mean, it's a flash hider, but this isn't the actual suppressor. So the silencer suppressor that would screw onto there, and it's a 51 tooth quick detach system. Nice. So I would ratchet onto there.
And then you got a flashlight.
Yeah, yep, that's the Cloud Defensive Owl.
Oh, wow, that's pretty natural, man.
About 1,000 lumen, a little over 1,000 lumen, 50,000 candela. That bad boy's bright and no throw. So, aim point T2, velocity precision trigger.
And then you got the iron sights right
there. Yeah, Magpul M-Bus Pros. Oh, you let it rip, man. So, you got your back and front. So, just pull them up. They're non-spring loaded, so it just pushes up.
Oh, this just pushes
up? Yep, right there. And then the one in the back does the exact same thing. So, now if your optic goes down, you still got your sights. Or if you'd like to run them co-witness.
Man, I was like looking into building one. I know who I have to inbox now.
Dude, I'm outstanding at spending other people's money. Awesome at spending
That's
other people's
awesome,
money.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah, man, Magpul's a great rifle.
So it's a Magpul handle.
Yeah, Magpul Furniture. So Magpul's a great company. They were cool, man. They sponsored some good stuff. Yeah, out of Oregon.
Man, that's outstanding, my man. I will let me do it the right way here. Push up on the boy. Bam. All right. I'll return this to you, sir.
He's like, I'm taking it out. I'll give this back to you. Yeah, that's a blast, dude.
So I love AKs more than I like the AR platform. And I am a big fan of the M4. I love me an M4, but when I first shot my first AK, that's what I kind of decided that was going to be my move.
Not a super, listen, so like right now all the AK guys in the interwebs that would look at this are aghast that I would bring out a Palmetto State AK, but it works for me. I primarily run an AK for demo purposes. So when I shoot class and I shoot a ballistics demo, I like to run an AK just so they have a gun to speak AK. Mm-hmm. It's a different language, and also to run it as a demo with the different caliber. So.
And this shoots at 7.62.
Yeah, it's 7.62 by 39. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, Palmetto State, all Magpul's UCOV furniture. Oh, not too much done to it. I didn't go too crazy. That's not pimped out like my AR.
Yeah. So what?
That's a step above basic white girl AK.
Yeah. See, it feels like you have like three different options here on your.
So there is, but they're not there. They're not real. So it's just safe and semi. So that's just a semi.
So it has an A.
So in a real AK, it would have three settings. It would have automatic,
and then
it would have safe, automatic, and semi-automatic. Correct.
Nice. Well, that's cool that you're. Selector lever does that.
Yeah, that's how they set them up. I think that's just
neat, because you can get it right there anyway. Nice.
It would be cool if it had a fun switch, but it doesn't.
Oh, I love AKs. Like my buddy, I have a friend that, like, he threw it into the mud. Like, he has, like, a little pit at his house. He threw it. He's like, all right, shoot it.
You shoot him
I
with
dumped
top,
the whole mag.
Shoot him with the top cover off.
And it was, like, the aluminum, like, the shitty steel rounds.
Yeah, you can take the top cover off and shoot them. I mean, you can do a lot of stuff with
them. Yeah, man, they're pretty crazy.
They're tanks.
How do you get this guy going?
Push him.
Same thing. My God. Yeah. That's pretty ergonomic. I don't know, man. The AR ones was better than this one, for sure. This one I have to actually try.
Yeah, try. You got to work on it a little bit. Yeah, it's not as good.
I have to be a man to use this one.
It was a little bit goofy.
She could use a little cleaning, Phil.
On clean guns, man. You run them wet and dirty. That's all you got to do. All
right. There you are, sir.
I trade you. That one's so we're empty. We're good there as well. So that's one of my... That's one of my work guns, one of my demo guns, Glock 17.
That's a big old mag there.
Yeah, it's got a Arondo extender on it, so it runs it out to about 22 rounds, plus 5. So it's a Gen 5 Glock 17 MOS. So running the Trigicon, running the dot.
God, that feels good.
Yeah.
So this
press,
is this
press
has
the trigger,
tritium?
So clear it out and press the trigger and see. The trigger feels, if you're used to Glock triggers, then press trigger on that.
Yeah, that's about right. Let me compare it to mine. I will do the comparison right now.
Without going bang.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, man, it's pretty much the same. I love the grips that you run.
Yeah, yeah, they're stippling, so nice. It's cutting it in with a wood burner.
Mm-hmm. I love your CCO. How much are these?
So those, you can get them on sale about $400. So yeah, it's Trigicon RMR 06 Type 2 is what that dot is.
That's really nice.
Gives you all the advantages.
So you're using a tritium.
It's actually battery driven.
This one is.
Yeah, forget the sights. The sights don't mean anything. Look for the dot. So the sights are just backup, just like your rifle when you flip them up. So you're looking for that red dot, and that's battery based.
But this is a tritium sight post.
Fiber optic.
Okay.
Yeah. You got it. Yeah, just a fiber optic pin.
Mm-hmm. What's your opinion on like the tritium sights and stuff like that?
So tritium sights are great upgrades. My opinion is in most cases they're unnecessary. I'm a big fan. I run fiber optic sights. Mm-hmm. So just as robust, just as durable. I actually think they pop a little bit better with light. So you end up with a little bit better. This is the real fun. This is where the training gets real when you bring one of these out. So.
What's the significance? Oh, and I'll return that to you. Sir.
That's a Glock 17T. So that's a simunition. That's a Glock for force and fire ammunition.
Can I push the mag in on that?
Yeah.
And it sucks because like there's no actual rounds in it. But like that's the one thing I liked about my Smith & Wesson. But Walther's are so nice. Will you click it and it's just. It just has its noise.
Sure.
And it's perfect. I'll bet when this is full, it's more of a bitch.
It's full. It depends. If you're rocking it full and you're running on a closed slide. So it's training like everything else. I mean, it gets to the point when you get to the... I mean, it's just becomes second nature. You know, you come in as you're hitting your reload. So it just seats. And you're just Nice. Ready to rock and roll.
Are you...
I'm actually hitting the slide release lever.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So are you really fast at doing, like... Can you dump a mag and throw another... Like, I've seen the guys where they drop the mag and another one's coming in immediately.
Yeah, so you should get... You should get fast at everything. You should get as fast as everything in the world except for pressing the trigger, so you can take as much time as you need in pressing the trigger.
Good, see that blue one again?
Yeah, yeah, man. A good reload out of concealed carry or a duty... duty rig, and particularly a competition rig, good reloads in a competition, you want them in right around a second. Mm-hmm. Anything way far north of a second, and you're starting to get into, you know, grandpa with his walker territory. So you're going way too slow, and you need to work on your skills. So that's 17T. That's not capable of firing live ammunition. That'll only fire the force-on-force marking rounds. So that's paintball on steroids.
Wow.
Everything about it. It's a Rogue gun. It's registered.
Everything's set up. Is there something... Now, I'm curious. I want to look at the mags.
Mags are identical. Those mags, you can swap them.
So how come... What's special about this weapon that makes it only fire those rounds? Yeah, what's the filter?
So depending on what ammunition type you're using, there's a couple companies that make force-on-force ammunition, and the two that break down is one is branded for FX barrels, so that would be your simunition, your force-on-force brand. The other is called UTM. What they do is there are a couple things in place. So if you take a look.
Yep, definitely.
So the barrel, if you look down without looking down the barrel, like crazy, you can see how it's offset.
There's like a little pin-looking thing in there.
Yeah.
Or something to that effect. There's like a little...
That's just plastic shavings.
Yeah.
No, but you can see how it's offset. It's not centered. It's not the full diameter of the bore.
I do see that.
Depending on what they do, so it's actually a different, slightly different caliber of the ammunition, which doesn't allow live ammunition to feed. So live ammunition that would try to feed up into this, if you try to feed a live 9mm, it's too big. It won't go in. So it's sub-calibers, so it shrinks caliber, so it sub-calibers a little bit.
Can I look at the barrel on the other end now? Because I'm kind of curious. It must
Here's
match.
How we'll do this, and we'll do it real safe. Yeah. So we'll do this, we'll clear it, safe direction.
Nice. Okay.
The ramp's a little bit different. The ramp geometry, it's got the cuts in it.
Yeah, it does look a lot different.
Yeah, and if you take a...
It's got some little...
Yeah, it's plastic
remnants here.
So if
That's
you take
cool.
a actual live 9mm
But
round,
it is rifled.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it shoots just like it. So if you take a real live 9mm round, it won't chamber.
Hmm.
It can't go into the chamber. That should seat in a regular, that would drop all the way in and seat.
Absolutely.
This won't. If they were still installed in the gun, the slide would hang up and stay somewhere.
And then the
open.
Hammer can't even make contact.
Hammer can't make contact. Striker can't hit it, can't do its thing. Yep. For sure. These are awesome, man. These are the best ring tools out there.
That is awesome. So how much are those weapons?
Same price as a regular Glock.
Nice.
And you can't buy them. Unless you're law enforcement, military, or a professional trainer.
Nice.
And you got to jump through a bunch of hoops.
Nice.
No, not too many hoops, but you got to play a lot. Yeah, they're not generally available.
Definitely.
There's nothing legally that stops you from buying them. Mm-hmm. You can. They just won't sell them to you. So you have to wait till it hits like Gunbroker.
Mm.
Oh. Got toys laying around everywhere, man.
So the hollow points that you use, what do you prefer there? And it doesn't even, looks like those are like steel casings?
No, they're... So it's a nickel,
it's like
a nickel coated brass.
Yeah. Okay.
Guide rod, where'd you go, man?
Nice.
We'll
find you later. Did you put it over here?
I don't think so.
Either.
We'll track her down later.
Yeah.
I'm not worried about it.
I believe these ones, and they're like corroded as hell. These ones are like, I bought them, they were advertised as like, these are law enforcement hollow points. Is that legitimate?
SIG ammo?
I don't remember.
Yeah, it's SIG ammo. Yeah. SIG casing. Yeah, I mean, that's everybody. So that comes down to marketing gimmicks.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody wants to market some of this. This is
so
law enforcement duty approved.
Does law enforcement use full metal jacket or do they use hollow points? Nice. Okay. I did not know that.
Yep.
These are cool. So what's the purpose of that cross in there?
So those are cross striations. They put them in there to aid and keep consistent expansion. So essentially as the round hits something, it's supposed to expand.
Yeah.
By putting the striations in it, hopefully that it's expanding into like a flower petal consistently, as opposed to chunks breaking off or doing different things or folding over or going different directions. That's what they do them for. How much they actually affect the bullet performance?
Probably negligible or something. So what have you seen these, I might be getting the name wrong, But it's like the RIP
XD. Rip ammo, rip ammo. So rip ammo and stuff like
they're
rip
like
ammo.
Machined copper around.
Yep,
I have some of those
solid
in there.
Copper. Usually the thing with rip ammo makes a lot of claims, and they got ballistic testing to show you this, to show you that. They run much, much lower weight bullet at much higher velocities, and their solid copper projectiles are designed to break into little pieces when it hits tissue and like rapidly transfer energy. My opinion is I've seen them not perform against gelatin like you shoot them against ballistic gel.
Yeah.
They work great. They perform,
how
but that's a very static test.
Yeah.
In practical application on them, it's all physics, man. Nothing in the world is voodoo science. It's physics. It's mass times velocity.
Yeah.
If you take something and you cut the mass by breaking it into pieces, then you lower the energy. Mm-hmm. Pistol energy already sucks.
Yeah.
It's just not. It's not the same as a rifle. So even though you add velocity, you purposely make something that breaks into pieces, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. And then you shoot them through any kind of barrier like auto glass.
Yeah.
Or through something, and it gets real bad real fast.
So let me ask you, you were saying about how, yeah, like especially if you're shooting through things, it's going to completely mitigate whatever damage they're doing to the thing on the other side. Do you know about these frangible rounds? Were they kind of like powder?
Yeah. Frange rounds in defensive are pretty terrible because they don't. Most of frange rounds are not. I know there are some out there that are supposed to be designed for self-defense. Again, they break apart. The best bullet performance, and all you got to do is look to the guys that hunt. If you asked your super most seasoned experienced hunter, if you could pick a perfect bullet, he'd say, okay, all right, I got 160 grain, 168 grain, 308 round. I'm going to shoot it, say a spire point, like a soft lead point. Perfect performance of that bullet would mean that when it got done expanding, it would double in diameter. So it would go from 0.3 to 0.6, somewhere around 0.6 ideally. And it would retain 100 or nearly close to 100% of its weight. So post-expansion weight would still be 168 grains or 167 or something like that. Mm-hmm. That's perfect bullet performance. The hunting world understands it. Then the self-defense world tries to come up with all these crazy gimmicks.
And
it wants to do this and wants to do that. Ultimately, hunting bullets strive to not break the bullet apart, but to keep it as one chunk to maximize energy delivery. In handgun calibers, it's not a big of a deal because the energy transfer isn't as great as it is in rifle calibers. Rifles, mm-hmm. the energy transfer is there.
Yeah. So I think like the frangible rounds and like even those, the RIP ones, I think they're advertising. One of the things about them is that the only way you can remove the round and the damage is if you get it surgically removed. Like, you're not going into a hotel room and being a punisher and digging it out with a knife, you know?
Yeah,
you need a trained surgeon to do that.
And what I tell guys is you ain't digging out. I mean, you ain't digging rounds out in a hotel room if it's a Full Metal Jacket.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, you're just not. If it bounces off a bone and digs in there, it takes... the way a lot of guys teach is based out of... So there's this huge... There's an entire industry... And it's sales. I get it. I understand why it happened. You can track it through history.
Yeah.
It's ammunition manufacturers. It's gun companies selling you different calibers to sell you new guns, sell you new ammo. Every couple of years, you got to sell you some. These are products that generally don't break. In the real use cycle of most people, if you buy a gun, you're never going to break it. You're never going to shoot enough to break it.
Mm-hmm.
Very few
those
people.
Glock,
very few
stuff.
People are out there shooting guns enough to break. I mean, mm-hmm. you can do it. I mean, I break guns every year. Guys shooting them a lot will break guns, will break parts. But they're mechanical devices. You fix you got a $500 gun. Oftentimes it's fixed with a $5 spring.
Yeah.
And you're right back in business. So if they want to keep continuing to have your business, they got to come up with new gimmicks.
Mm-hmm.
Ammunition's is very often kind of that new gimmick. When you boil down the stopping power debate, whether it's caliber or anything else, and you talk to the biggest experts in that, which is talk to doctors, go to your ERs and talk to docs. Most of your docs, when they train in this and having some access to doctors that were on our SWAT team and worked with us and got a chance to talk to us and pick their brains. When you talk to docs and you talk to docs in conferences and they have their training conferences, they'll all tell you the same thing. Caliber doesn't mean anything. The number means jack shit. It comes down to three factors. Where you hit them, how many times you hit them, and the time to advance medical care. How fast you get them to a hospital. That's what determines lethality of a round, not whether it starts with a 9 or a 4, you know, if it's this, that, or even a 2 or a 3. You know, it could be a 22, 25, 32, 380. 9mm, 40, 45, 357, 44 mag, doesn't matter. It's those other three factors that are what really matter, not, oh, well, you know, I shot him with 45, he dropped dead instantly. But I shot him with a 22, he won't die. It doesn't work that way. Mm. So, got to hit him a lot, which is why I coach people when they ask. I say, get the gun you shoot the best. Accuracy translates to hitting them. Number of times, you know, actually wear on your body, hitting them where you want to hit them. Get a gun you control well, can control shot to shot, recoil. For most people, the overwhelming majority of people.
Oh, my God.
Hey, Nick, what's up? Listen, dude, I'm cool with it. I mean, you do you, dude. I mean, do you know Nick? Do we know Nick?
That's Nick the Speedo guy that I mentioned.
Oh, Nick Speedo, dude. Yeah, sweet. Yeah.
Thanks all for popping in, Nick.
Yeah, man, that's awesome, dude. I mean, shit, there's a category. There's everything's got a category, dude.
There's worse stuff to jerk off to, that's for sure.
Yeah. All right. It was a stopping power talk. That's what it was, wasn't it?
It was pretty exciting. I was tantalized. That's definitely interesting information, though, that, like, this is actual, like, testimony you've heard
from. Yeah, man, this is docs. They'll tell you. It doesn't matter, dude. It's you got to hit them. You got to hit them a lot. And how fast you get them to the hospital. That's what determines whether or not they survive. Rough numbers are roughly 70% of people that present to hospital setting with a handgun injury survive. You flip that to high-velocity rifle, and the numbers almost completely flip to 70% mortality rate or higher mortality rates in high-velocity rifle. They're just a lot more damaging to the body.
Yeah.
So you can impart enough energy with a rifle to actually have knockdown power, have stopping power to hit them with enough energy if you hit them multiple times. And even rifle, for military application, rifles get bad raps because the overwhelming majority of military use is utilizing full metal jacket ammunition that's not designed to expand on impact and transfer energy.
Yeah, it's to penetrate.
It's designed to penetrate and at best tumble. But it isn't designed to necessarily transfer energy, whereas a hollow point or a soft point or some type of ammunition that is designed to transfer energy, massive difference. So
that's definitely interesting stuff. So I have a friend that lives in Alaska, and I remember having a gun conversation with him. And he carries 45 because the main concern out there is
bears.
People. My man.
Yeah, exactly. Bears.
So one of the arguments he said to me, and I'd like to hear kind of some of your feedback on this, is if 7 rounds, that's what he has in his carry pistol, if 7 rounds doesn't do the job, you don't need more gun or more ammunition. You need more people in that situation.
Yeah, more gun. So it's funny. I just this morning I read an article about another guy that killed a bear with a 9mm.
Oh, wow.
Because last year was one that killed a large grizzly in Alaska with his Glock 17. The article I read this morning was a Beretta 92. It was a old standard military issue style Beretta 92 9mm. So 9mm will absolutely kill a bear. So the question is, am I better to have 22 rounds on a Glock 17 to kill that bear, or am I better to have a 44 mag with 6 rounds in it? The short answer is you're better to have a shotgun with slugs or buckshot or a large bore rifle.
Yeah.
My dad's best friend from high school has been a guide out west, various from Idaho to Wyoming, a couple different states out west. Since he graduated school, he bounced out and has been a guide for the last, God, I'm getting old, I don't know, 40, 50 years, whatever that's been, 50 years that he's been out there guiding, and they carry 12 gauge to deal with bear. That's their solution to it. None of the handguns, this is the exact same problem with humans. The handguns aren't great. I'd almost be tempted if tomorrow I go into bear country, I'd probably roll my 9mm for capacity. That's all I could take. I wouldn't go out and buy a 44 that only gets 6 shots in. I'd probably roll my 17 that I got 22 rounds in with a +5 on it.
So in your opinion, in that specific situation, quantity would be quality.
Yeah, I mean, I'd go for quantity on it. If I had my choice and in most scenarios, I think I would. I wouldn't be solely trusting my life. If I know I'm going into bear country where I got a threat of bear and I'm that concerned about it, then I'm probably up into a shoulder-based system. So I'm up into a 12-gauge. I'm up into a 308 or a 300 Win Mag, or I'm up into something. Actually, it would be really cool to be like an Omen, like a 300 Win Mag AR. So I can rock them with like
those are crazy.
Yeah, so then I got capacity. Then I got it all. Or an AK. I've heard every now and then you see the forum boards of guys rocking AKs because you got a 30 cal gun with 30 round capacity that you could, with good ammo selection, you could let rip. So
yeah.
I don't know, man. Bears are, dude, anything that can eat me scares me a little bit. Like you can straight up legit like eat me. Like, yeah, that's not cool.
Yeah, agreed. That's I think
bears and tigers and sharks. Yeah. And...
none of that. It's not good news. Real life monsters.
Yeah, that's so like
not under
like,
your bed.
Dude, I tell you what, man. One of my like a cool life event I got to do. I took a vacation and we went to Big Island, Hawaii. And we got to snorkel with the giant manta rays. And like they just eat plankton. They don't eat people. Like they don't eat anything. They don't got teeth. They just got big giant mouths. But when you swim with them, like they open their mouths up and it's big enough you could like fall into it. Like if they wanted to swallow you, they could. They don't.
How big are those
they're
things?
They're enormous. Like they get like 20-foot wingspan.
That's crazy.
Oh, they're enormous.
What?
And the way they feed, they drop down LED lights on surfboards on the surface and then the lights illuminate like the photoplankton and everything and these rays come up and they basically do barrel rolls with their mouths, like their filter feeders, and they just barrel roll up through a barrel, but like it's like a gigantic, enormous looking flying wing
that
coming at
crazy.
You with a huge mouth coming right at you. You're like, I'm gonna get swallowed and die.
Yeah,
but I mean, no teeth, so I'm okay with that. But sharks are sharks get a little dicey.
Yeah, I think so.
Like, they can eat you,
that's no doubt. Cool. You follow that Nature is Metal channel on YouTube or on it?
I've seen it, yeah.
Dude, I'm gonna have to start sending you some of that stuff. Every time I see a good one, I'm like, oh. Blast it to 20 of my friends.
Yeah.
It's always a good time. So that's definitely awesome. I was in the Adirondacks and I actually took my Glock because I was thinking just the fact that I think you're way more likely to require the use of a firearm against a wild animal than you are a person. I think that
depends on what your threat stimulus is.
I guess that's true. I guess in my specific situation, I guess I can speak on my anecdotal kind of stuff. Like that's my opinion on that.
You roll the AT, it's probably the opposite. Like you roll the Appalachian Trail, you go to Maine to Georgia, you're more likely to deal with some dude on a trail looking to do something like real shaky, deliverance style to you than you are bumping into a bear that could actually kill you.
Yeah, so true that. Especially if it's like a black bear, tend to be more scared of us than we
except
are
from the
now.
Get-go, man. We're animals, so
yeah,
I mean that's
true that.
You gotta be prepared on all sides of it.
No doubt about that. So just to kind of recap on like your credentials and everything, do you want to kind of give your tactical history up? Or even do you want to kind of show what your daily is?
Give my background. I mean, whichever I can do it. I go quick, fast, in a hurry. So background wise,
So you started in the Corps, I believe.
Started in the Corps, yeah. Spent 4 years in the Marine Corps. Back in the '90s, not much going on. So when there's not much going on in the Corps, in the units I was lucky enough to be part of, we got a lot of great training.
That's awesome.
I figured out and got a chance to understand that I really enjoyed teaching. So I started off teaching platoon level CQB, and then was a water survival instructor for RMU. Got to be a tourist on Uncle Sam's dime. I mean, that really what I did there was the extent of that.
Can you kind of touch on the water survival training?
Yeah, man. So
I did one course of that. And I remember like we did the treading on water thing. And I'm like, oh, I can totally fill my pants with air. And then they put us in the full battle rattle. And I walked off and immediately fell and just stripped everything. And fucking panicked to the top.
Yeah,
dropped the rubber duck M16.
So the Marine Combat Instructor Water Survival Program, it's a month-long school. Has one of the highest washout rates in the Marine Corps for all training. It's
it's
a tough school. But what's cool about it is outside of the Naval Rescue Swimmer Program and the Coast Guard Rescue Swimmer Program, those are more intense. It's beyond those two programs. It's one of the most in-depth water survival instructor and water survival type programs you're going to get in the military pipeline. And basically, you name it, you think you can do it in water. I mean, it was 4 weeks long. Every day is just swim till you puke kind of deal. So you do conditioning swims morning, coming back from lunch, and before you go for the day, and in between your conditioning swims, in between your three workouts of the day, you just swam. You did you did technique work, but you did swim. You would do swims. You do conditioning. We do drills. You name it, all kinds of stuff. You learn how to. You just get real comfortable in water. You learn where your limits are, and you learn how to be as comfortable as possible in water without freaking out. Stuff like tying you up. Like they'll tie you up, tie your hands and feet, and you go swim the length of the pool.
Often did you have like cadets drowning in that situation?
So some shallow water drowning or some shallow water blackouts, so doing underwater swims. We had a couple guys in our class that got whacked by shallow water drowning. You drop guys in most weeks through most evolutions, you drop some people. We started with 40 some, and I think we graduated. I think we had 4 or 5 that got the MOS, and like 11 that finished the school but didn't rate the MOS because they didn't pass all the the time. So it's it's dumping a bunch of people. So that's, you're bouncing people. Strict, man. And it's crazy. We had,
like,
we had
10%.
We had collegiate level swimmers that bounced out of the class. I mean, they were faster than everybody. They swam really, really well. They just find something. It's about comfort. That course, the biggest thing for me was finding, just getting real comfortable. And from the time I was a kid, I was always real cool and comfortable in water. Didn't freak out, didn't panic. It's about not panicking and staying cool. And just embracing the suck, because you're going to, like, you're going to get spazzed past the point of physical exhaustion. You just got to keep going and keep your mental wits about you so you don't freak out, because water's a universal phobia. So you take water, heights, things like that we naturally fear. Suffocation is a natural fear all humans have, and if pushed with the right stimulus, they'll get it. So you just got to manage that throughout the course and manage that and stay cool. Like anything else, the calmer you stay, the better off you are, the better you'll perform. So
true.
Yeah. So I did that. I was the water survival instructor then for our MU. We got a chance to go float around and be a tourist on Uncle Sam's dime. Spent some time floating off Kosovo while they were blowing stuff up in Kosovo in the 90s.
Nice.
And then bounced out, went into law enforcement, and did my first 14 years there in law enforcement as patrol. Got as a patrol supervisor.
Was that in Pennsylvania?
Yeah, it was Lancaster County. Yep.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, local. So did that. Did 13 of those 14 in SWAT as well. It's a secondary assignment. It's a part-time assignment. Mm-hmm. So I was our team training coordinator. So I coordinate all the sustainment and outside training. We trained twice a month. So we'd run those trainings and coordinate and document all that training. I joke around and say, if I can hit you with it, shoot you with it, spray it on you, zap you with it. I'm an instructor somewhere. I got a certificate that says, yeah, you can teach people this.
Nice.
So I did that. I bounced in 14. I left law enforcement because I got an offer to go full-time in the training market and work for a company running. At the time, I actually jumped in first in their corporate development office and ran their corporate development office, and then worked up and finished out as the VP of range and training for that company. Political winds changed. Politics changed. The gun industry nosedived after Trump's election. And that
really?
Yeah, but it took about a 30% hit nationally.
What? I didn't know.
Tanked. Man. So everybody buys, Obama's the boss. Everybody's scared the Democrats are going to take the guns. Everybody buys guns.
Yeah.
Trump got elected. Wildly enough, 8 years under an Obama administration, the threat was always there. The gun sales were through the roof. Every time there'd be a mass shooting, sales would fly skyrocket. Best gun salesman in America. He enacted no meaningful legislation. There was no meaningful impact. In fact, there were actually some pro-gun rulings that came out of the ATF during the Obama administration. As crazy as that sounds. Trump gets elected. The entire gun culture goes, Everyone believed the 8-year war on your Second Amendment rights is over. They believed campaign speeches. Everybody went, this is great. Everybody stopped buying. Gun industry tanks 30% in the first year.
30%. That's incredible.
It goes, crashes, tanks. Sales go way down. Wildly enough, as is often the case, what's perceived as the pro-gun administration, a Republican administration, there's been horrible legislation. There's been horrible junket. There's been executive action, like banning bump stocks. So they banned bump stocks. So took a chunk of plastic accessory and classified it as a machine gun.
What's your opinion on that? Because didn't the Las Vegas shooter guy utilize that?
Yep, he had bump stocks on his guns. So here's my opinion on that. My opinion is that to arbitrarily take an accessory, which whether you can argue whether it is effective, whether it's not, it increases the rate of fire. It can mimic the rate of a machine gun fire. You can legally purchase machine guns in the United States. You go, it costs more money. Certainly Paddock in Las Vegas had the economic means to buy machine guns if he wanted to. He didn't. He chose
that
not
gentleman
to.
That actually was the perpetrator of that shooting.
Yep, that piece of shit. Yeah, he could have. He had economic means to do it. Yeah. He didn't. He bought these bump stocks. Through no legislation, to simply take an accessory, to take something and say, this is now, we've reclassified this as a machine gun, sets a horrifically dangerous precedent and an absolute overreach. And at the end of the day, we'll do absolutely nothing, zero zilch, to improve safety. A lot of people in the gun community looked at that and said, it's a novelty. It's a toy. We don't care. If you want to, we're not going to die on the hill of bump stocks. If you want to take the bump stocks, go ahead and take them. I think a lot of them now are seeing, some of those people who held that opinion are starting to see the folly in that. Because it wasn't legislation. It was a further infringement. It did nothing to advance anyone's safety. Not that I think that just whether or not it's going to be effective shouldn't be the only benchmark we look at it. Certainly, it's one we got to look at in a reasonable society. We got to look and say, will this actually work? And 99.999, okay, I'll say it, 100% of the legislation that's proposed won't do a damn thing to curb violent crime, because the criminals will continue to be criminals and disobey the laws.
Yeah, I've said this with a lot of the conversations, because I have a lot of friends that are really anti-gun. And, you know, that douchebag that fucking shot all those people, how many casualties did he, you know, have? Like, you know, like not even 100. Yeah. If he wanted to kill the most people, guns are not the best option.
No,
for that.
I mean, look,
he should have like filled a van with some, you explosives, know, explosives. Yeah, that you can make with stuff you get at Home Depot. You know what I mean?
The deadliest domestic terror attack in the United States was Oklahoma City, 168 killed with a fertilizer bomb.
That's what I'm saying.
You know, look at Nice, France. It's a truck-based attack. So that's a running trend in terror attacks now. Don't use any weapons. They're too hard. Go to U-Haul, run a U-Haul, and look for a crowd. Pin the pedal to the floor and run over as many people as you possibly can, and do that. Yeah, so that action against the bump stocks, while on the surface of it, I don't own a bump stock. I've shot them. I'm sure they're fun. I've shot real machine guns that are more fun than bump stocks. You can bump fire a gun without a bump stock. You can hold your belt loop and pull the gun and bump fire it. You can do the exact same thing. They're a novelty. They were silly. They didn't have a purpose outside of recreation. I also think it was wildly dangerous in precedent and worthless in scope that they were regulated. Because where does it go from there? So the next president, so this is a supposedly pro-gun administration. Republicans are typically known as pro-gun. What's to say the next time that the Democratic Party, which is typically viewed as anti-gun, gets into power, that president doesn't go, well, we're going to reclassify aftermarket triggers, like the trigger I have on my rifle, and say, that's now, if you have one of those, it's now a machine gun because it aids in firing that weapon faster and more accurately. So that's a deadly accessory. That's now illegal. And then, you know, from where does it stop? Where do we continue on? And none of it is, it all continues to be a reach, and it all continues to have no impact whatsoever on the net goal of enhancing safety, or more importantly, I hate when we say we want to enhance safety, because at the end of the day, you can't uninvent this. The cat's out of the bag. Guns are not going to be disinvented. They're there. I mean, you're not going to remove every gun from the planet. You're just not. You're not going to remove every gun from this country. You just simply are not going to do that. So what's the real goal here? I mean, where does that kind of end out? So every time we have this, and my big gripe, man, with the whole gun control world is this. For 100 years, we have continued to advance legislation to erode the Second Amendment, and it is always done in the same way. It's done in the same way, and it's done usually in the terms of tragedy. You can watch. So
that's an emotive response.
Prohibition created the violent rise of organized crime, created the National Firearms Act of 1934. You can watch through. You can watch gun control enacted post-JFK assassination that infringed. You can watch gun control enacted in the mid-80s under Reagan after his assassination attempt. You can watch the Clinton assault weapons ban. You bounce through. It's always just little chipping away, little bits and pieces, and always under the terms of increasing safety and always under the terms of compromise. If I say to you, hey, man, let's compromise, that means I give you something you want, part, not everything, and you give me part of something I want, and we meet in the middle. That's compromise. To the gun control world, compromise means you just shut the fuck up and let us take more of your stuff and just shut up. Universal background checks is my favorite. Like right now, that's the hot topic. And I think there's a solid chance that it's going to pass. It'll have 0% impact on stopping the next mass shooter. None. It'll pass because of the emotions of a mass shooter. It'll have zero impact on it. Universal background checks, if we were having an honest compromise, the conversation should look like this. Universal background checks, okay, with one caveat. We now also have universal concealed carry. So you get universal background checks, meaning no private sale. And I would believe in that you would still need to have significant amount of very specific language allowing things like family to family transfer.
Yeah.
Allowing things like loaning guns to friends at the range to shoot. Like if I handed... under certain circumstances, under certain versions of the law, what you and I just did in handing you that gun to look at it would have been a felony because you didn't do a background check.
That's crazy.
If we're at the range and shooting, you say, hey, man, you want to shoot this gun?
That would be a felony.
It would be a felony. So make sure that language says that's not the case. But if we're actually buying a gun from a person whose job, who are making a transfer of a gun, you want to do universal background checks, the only way I'd even entertain the conversation would be in the same breath that said, okay, now we're going to have 50-state concealed carry reciprocity. That's compromise. You get a little bit, I get a little bit. I don't like universal background checks. I think that's an overreach. I lean a lot harder towards the all gun laws are infringement zone. But if I were to ever entertain it, it would need to be under compromise. Meaning I get this.
You get that.
You get that. Not, no, you just shut up for our safety and for the kids. We take. Because the goal is to chip away little by little.
Yeah. So I like in my personal opinion, this is me voicing just what I think. Generally speaking, what it seems to be the big problem and one of the most common denominators with all of these mass shootings is just psychological health of these individuals. Yeah. There's legislation being, you know, proposed to try to take away a lot of rights from people who have, like, an example that threw me for a loop was if you have a medical marijuana card,
right,
you should not be able to own a firearm. What's your opinion on that?
Yeah,
I think that, honestly, it doesn't correlate.
Well, as states, and Pennsylvania is one of them as well, so as states continue to, so, you know, me personally, again, just my personal opinion,
yeah,
I wish we'd get off the pot. And what I mean by that is, the old phrase, shit or get off the pot.
Yeah.
Everyone knows that 50-state legalization of all use of marijuana is coming. It's going to come recreationally. It's going to come medicinally. It's going to come recreationally. Just knock it off. Clear it federally. Make it happen. Make the determination then. Determine it. Place that under the same language that you place alcohol. So if you're convicted of, you know, multiple offenses of overuse of that, then sure, that could trigger. If that triggers a high enough criminal offense to keep you from owning a gun, then it does. If not,
it's the same thing with alcohol.
It is the exact same thing. It's no different. So for that, yeah, I don't think there's any. To me, there's no correlation there that should prohibit, particularly on the medical marijuana side of things. The hitch there is the federal side because it is still illegal federally. That's what's stopping it on the federal form. That should clear. That should, you know, I don't know what the latest figures are, but I know the overwhelming majority of states is high. Like it's in, is it 42 or 43 states now of legal medical marijuana? It's most states. So it's almost the whole country. And a fair number now have recreational, and within 10 years, it's going to be 50 and 50. It's going to be, all states are going to have legal and recreational marijuana. And I don't think that's going to be an issue, but the federal government has to catch up and level with that. It's one of those funny areas where two groups don't normally necessarily agree with each other, fight the same fight from different areas, and that's state rights. Like, how much should a state be allowed to say no over what the federal government? And I've always leaned more towards the, if I lean towards whichever gives you more rights, whichever is doing a better job of honoring what I think the Constitution wanted, which is a lot more liberty and a lot more libertarian view and interpretation of what you can do. I'm as I get older, and not that I'm an old guy, but as I get older, I lean further and further libertarian, and you know, I love to joke around and say, hey man, I'm completely down. Like, what I do is what I do. If what you do doesn't impact me, like, do you, man, knock yourself out. Like, I'm real cool with a gay couple defending their pot farm with their AR and AK. That's,
I'll drink to that, man.
I mean, what do I care? I don't really care. I don't care. I seriously don't. It's an interesting side from the blue side of it, from the law enforcement side too. Your average cop out there, attitudes have shifted a lot there as well. And areas are decriminalized now, but you still have some that don't, some that do. Individual cop opinions on what should be the criminalization of marijuana use as states wrestle with that. Most individual cops get to the point where they hit a point in their career and it's like, even if it's a state where it's still criminalized.
Yeah.
Okay, he's got to join. Like, seriously.
Get
back in the car. So you've seen attitude shifts a lot like that, but it's going to have to track gun ownership specifically, too. It's going to have to change up and catch up and adapt to it as well. So we'll see how it goes. But yeah, right now, the federal prohibition of marijuana, the continued scheduling of marijuana as a controlled substance, puts it onto, it's still on your 4473. It's still a question on your gun form. So if you are a legal marijuana, if you have a medical marijuana card, then that becomes the question is, can you own firearms? Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's going to continue to be there are dudes out there. I mean, there are some much better minds and much better legal minds out there than I'll ever be that are fighting that fight. And there are guys there's a dude here in this state that's one of the preeminent attorneys on both gun rights and also now starting to represent the cannabis industry. And interestingly enough, he's running those kind of both routes. He's running a lot of casework in the cannabis industry and running a lot of casework, his primary in the firearms, and they do collide. And one of the areas they collide is in medical marijuana cards and medical marijuana use and firearms purchasing.
That's awesome. That was really great feedback, Phil. But what do you think, so like I was mentioning how like the common denominator seems to be like
mental health.
What do you think the best strategy to mitigate that stuff would be? But like one of the things I always say is, maybe it's not a legislation now, but generally speaking, most all of my friends that are firearms owners take that as a serious thing and they have the equipment to lock these things away keep them away from, anyone in their family that would, otherwise not be responsible with those weapons.
So mental health thing, I'll throw an opinion, but I'm far from an expert.
Yeah, of course. It's just...
And what I'd say on that is, I think that robust access to mental health is huge. I think that the continued work that a lot of great organizations are doing to destigmatize access to mental health, to view that, and you see that huge, you see a huge push in at-risk communities like veteran communities, law enforcement, first responder communities, where, you push it to the men and women in those positions that get mental health. There's no stigma. It's not going to ruin your career. You're not going to be looked down upon. It's still a fight. It's still a hesitation. It's still, there's peer pressure not to. A continued societal push towards making it okay to seek mental health is one part of it. I think that the other huge part, my personal opinion on the mass shooting side of things, is that we have developed as a nation, as our need for that information and the media's portrayal of that, we have turned mass shootings and mass killings into a cult of personality, that people seek that final piece of notoriety for themselves and know that they will get it. Whether they die in the attack, whether they live in that attack, they seek this because of this massive... Myself included, big chunk of my business is training and stuff like this, being prepared. And I've taught a lot of programs, counter around active killer interdiction and things like that. I'm disgusted to tell you that I could sit here and rattle off dozens of names of killers. I couldn't tell you names of those killers' victims. I can tell you, Sandy Hook is this guy. And I try my best not to say their names, and sometimes I slip. I generally try to, call them pieces of human filth or worthless trash or piece of shit. But we as a media really push that, or our media pushes that and give them instant cult and celebrity status.
I think in other countries they try to avoid that. They don't want to give you that platform to be a celebrity.
So Germany is an interesting case example. Mm-hmm. So Germany had a really horrible mass shooting had a mass killing at a school. And in response to that, one of the German responses was, I don't believe is the way that America should go. But as an example, they made it a criminal offense to ever print or publicly announce the name of the killer of any mass attack.
Yeah. I mean, so that dude's a fucking piece of shit for sure, but that definitely infringes on the right of free speech at the same time.
So really what you're asking, what I'm asking for is something that I think is almost unattainable in this nation and in any nation with a free press, which you need to have. If I believe super strongly in the Second Amendment, then I got to believe super strongly in the First and the Third and the Fourth and so on and so forth, which I do. And I don't believe that there should ever be legislation limiting that free press. But what I do think would be helpful would be an increase in self-regulation of that to understand. However, at the end of the day, as disgusting as this sounds, there's no vested interest whatsoever for the mass media conglomerate to do that.
It's really unfortunate.
It sells, and they know that, and it's dollars. The El Paso shooter, what was his name?
I don't know. Like just like you, I try not to even look at the guy's check names, out. You know?
The chief of police in El Paso has refused to release his name.
That's awesome.
His name's leaked, but the chief has never referred to him by name and has publicly made it known that he will not refer to the shooter by name. Now, his identity has been leaked by other sources, but he's limited it. And I really do believe that that's some self-regulation. A lot of that happens. So you get these folks, you get people, if you look at the profile, quote-unquote, of a mass shooter, you see a massive amount of not only just mental illness, there's not always recognizable, immediately diagnosable, recognizable outward symbols of mental illness. There are in a lot of cases, there are a lot of warning factors that tack up, but it takes a significant amount of training to kind of ID what those are. But most of these people are pushed to a precipice in their life, to a triggering event, and they're pushed past a point, and this becomes a self-harming act of notoriety, and we feed that and give that. It's why we continue to see them happen. They're not a new phenomenon. They've been happening for years and years and years. The deadliest school attack in the United States, you know when it happened?
Columbine, are you referring to?
Nope. 1928, the Bath School incident. So it was a guy who was shooting and using a bomb to kill school kids. Happened in the 20s.
Wow.
So that was a deadly school attack happened in the 20s. One of the first mass shootings in a scholastic setting was the University of Austin. So the person up in the clock tower shooting people. Back in the 60s.
Yeah, I was going to say, and that was a 60s. Former Marine?
That was a Marine, yep. Yeah, Full Metal Jacket. Everybody remembers the Full Metal Jacket scene. So, yeah. Anyone knows who Walt Whitman was? No? None of you dumbasses knows? That's the sign. That's my second language, by the way. I'm bilingual. I speak English and American cinema. So, it's all breaking the movie lines, right? Yeah, so they're not new phenomenon. They've been happening, but the rise of them because of the notoriety. So, I'm desperate. I'm suicidal. So I'm going to go out and I'm going to be known. I've lived a life. I'm not happy with the life I've lived. Most of them, if you track back, there's some perceived slight, real or perceived. Then we may not know what it is, but you know, I've been wronged and I'm going to get my notoriety. I'm going to do this. I'm going to let it rip. And at the end of the day, a lot of times, for a lot of these shootings, we're really trying desperately to rationalize the irrational.
Yeah.
Like we're seeking out, like humans don't want to hear. Humans want an answer for everything. There has to be a reason this happened. At the end of the day, sometimes there's no reason. Like, we don't know. I mean, you know, I was working the day that the Amish school shooting happened in Lancaster County. And listened to that unfold. And we were scrambling to get our SWAT team ready to go down and help out, even though it wasn't our area. It was an area covered by the state police. And we're scrambling, trying to get guys ready. And I was on duty, you know, at speed, lights and sirens. I was still 35, 40 minutes away.
Yeah.
So I was a significant amount away. I never got there. I didn't take part in it at all. But listening to it unfold on the radio, switching over to that radio channel, listening to it, trying to get everything rolling. You know, that's one where, you know, what was the motive? What was the reason? What was the rationale? Everyone wants to find, there has to be a reason why someone would do that. And you take that and you look at them and go, what's rational about taking 10 schoolgirls and shooting them in the head? There's nothing rational about that. So why are you trying to apply a rational logic to why they would do that? There's a certain level of chaos that exists. Call it chaos, call it evil, call it whatever you want. It's just there. And you can either bury your head in sand, not believe it's real, or you can do your best to fight it. And when you get to that level of human evil, you know, there's really only one solution to that, and that's countering that with the equal level of violence. So you're going to do that, well, we're going to shoot you in the face to stop you from doing that, and that's the only way that's going to work out. So.
Mm-hmm. This is kind of a controversial thing that I just kind of popped in my head with the last bit that you were saying there. I've heard law practitioner friends of mine say that if an intruder does make it into your house, you should shoot for the kill because you don't want them to be able to defend themselves in the court of law.
What's
your opinion on that? So, just touch on it quick.
Problem, man. So the way I train, the way everybody that is in the know trains and is doing it right. You train to stop the threat. And the way you teach that is you train to stop the threat. And sometimes in stopping that threat, death is a byproduct. So you don't know, there's no cop in America that's trained to shoot to kill. You're not trained to shoot to kill. You're trained to shoot to stop the threat. If stopping the threat means I shoot them 87 times in the head and there's nothing left but hamburger, well, they're going to die, probably. And they're dead. That's a byproduct. But the threat stopped. Mm-hmm. If they didn't stop until that 87th shot, then it's justifiable. You train to stop the threat. You don't shoot to kill. Just like you don't shoot purposely to wound. You shoot to stop the threat. If the threat stops psychologically, the threat stops physically, great. The threat's done. It's gone. But you're just training to stop the threat.
Yeah.
And then what happens, happens. So.
Awesome. I agree.
It gets trained a lot. And that's a lot of guys. And that's at attorneys or depending on... I love attorneys, man. Attorneys are great and terrible all at the same time. And I have a lot of friends that are awesome attorneys. I tell people, like, I make the joke. I tell people attorneys are like witches in the Wizard of Oz, right? There's good witches and bad witches. There's good attorneys and bad attorneys. You know how you tell the difference? It depends if you're paying them or not. Yeah. If you're paying them, they're good attorneys. If you're not paying them, they're the bad attorneys. You can take any case, and guys in professional force, even concealed carriers or cops, are notorious for, oh God, if I do this, I'll get sued. I'll do this, I'll do that. And I always say the same thing, Len. You know, do what's right. Do the right thing for the right reasons, with the right justifications, with proper justifications, proper moral, legal, ethical justifications to do it. And at the end of the day, I'm going to put two attorneys up there. One attorney is going to paint you like a saint. One attorney is going to take every point that they use to make you a saint and going to convince the jury you're a piece of shit devil. Mm-hmm. And they're the exact same points. The same 5 points in the middle that are your training, your experience, this, that, and next. One's going to paint you in a good light. One's going to paint you in a bad light. Doesn't make either of those attorneys. They're just doing their jobs.
Yeah.
Doing their jobs. If you're paying the one to make you look good, he's cool. He's Glinda. And then that one's the Wicked Witch of the West because he's trying to burn you. Either send you to jail or cost you a lot of money. Mm-hmm. So, but they're just dudes. They're dudes and ladies doing their job. They're 10-10-80.
Yeah.
Man, somebody's got to finish 10-10-80. Somebody's got to finish in last place at law school too. True so that. We call them public defenders. No, all joking aside. I'm just razzing you, public defenders. We love you.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. No, but the American justice system is as flawed as any system, man. Anything man-made has flaws, and including us ourselves. You know?
People are people, so you know, that's like all. You know, you get into the real deep governmental discussions. Is this going to work? Is that going to work? Here's what shakes out. They haven't invented one yet that lasts forever because they're run by humans. And what's going to happen to humans? Guess what? People with power are going to try to take advantage of people that don't have power. I don't care what bow you put on that. I think our system's pretty damn good. It's working.
Probably one of the better ones in the world. So far, so good, man.
I mean, but you can slap a constitutional republic. You can say it's democracy. You can say it's a socialist state, a dictatorship, a kingship, a theocracy, plurocracy. I don't care what it is. It's not gonna last forever. Mm-hmm. Through history, nothing's lasted forever. You can't point to a country and go, oh, that's been around since written time. Since the existence of written human records, that's been there and it's been governed the same way. It doesn't exist. Democracies, we're a little bit of a new experiment. We're a young experiment. I mean, I always laugh when everybody's like, oh yeah, America's a democracy. No, not really. We're a constitutional republic. You know, democracies, not so much, two wolves and a sheep voting on what's for dinner. So as long as you got a majority, 51 people say, cool, then the 51 can rule the 49. Well, eventually the 49 get pissed because the 51 rule everything in their favor and dump on the 49, and they get mad, they revolt, and you refresh and start over with a new kind of government. So we're trying something a little bit different. We'll see, man. I think that all of us are likely to not see the end of the experiment in our lifetimes. Maybe our grandkids, great-grandkids, great-great-grandkids will see either the end or see the validation that this was the pure form of human governing that finally worked. But I don't know, man. I know this. I've traveled overseas. I've been overseas. When it all said and done, for all our faults and disagreements and squabbles, right, left, Republican, Democrat, red, blue, I don't care. At the end of the day, it's still pretty damn good. And there's other countries that are beautiful too. And there's great countries out there and awesome places I've been and seen. I wouldn't trade a single one of them for America. I mean, not even close. I just wouldn't even come close. I mean, I wouldn't. Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, cool. Yeah, I'd like to live there now. I've never seen that.
I'll visit.
Yeah, beautiful place, man. Beautiful. Yeah. But I wouldn't. You pay what in taxes? No.
Oh, man.
No, free college, 70% tax rate. Yeah.
70%. No.
I get mad at the taxes I pay.
Yeah, so. Exactly, man. All right, man. Well, we've been talking for the better part of almost 3 hours here, man.
Yeah, dude.
So I kind of want to do like some closing with you right here. Can you give any advice for any law enforcement guys out there that maybe want to get involved in, like, the SWAT stuff? I know you said you went from, you know, being in the military to being a law enforcement officer to then, you know, getting involved with the SWAT stuff.
Yep.
And now in the TRADOC kind of side of things. What some advice you can give to any, like, law enforcement guys that are looking into getting into SWAT?
Yep. Train. Get training. So I give this advice to everybody across every board, no matter what you're looking to do. Better yourself in every category. Pick your weaknesses, get better at, get the best at your weaknesses, attack them. Understand that your agency and your municipality and your city or wherever, your state, whoever you work for, they're never going to send you to enough of anything. So take personal initiative and send yourself, you know, go find a jiu-jitsu gym and train. Go to the range, go take classes, go train on your own, go shoot on your own. Go enroll in a driving school, go do this, go do that. Just make yourself a more rounded trained officer. You know, continue to engage your brain and things and, you know, go learn Spanish, go learn, you know, another language, go engage and do yourself, and keep to it and gain yourself and make yourself marketable. And the same advice I give any cop across the board for any job, but SWAT, go and train. Don't just look, you know, make sure you got your, you know, go PT, do your thing. Everybody in the world, every SWAT team in the world wants to be PT junkies and shooting junkies. And when you get to the teams and you see teams and you work around SWAT teams, you find out you got guys in there that are, you know, high class CrossFit athletes and dudes that can just barely pass their team's obstacle course, pass it, but can just barely pass it. And neither of those two factors independent just by themselves make the difference of whether or not they're a good officer. For that team. Same with shooting.
Yeah.
Most SWAT guys aren't as good at shots as most people would think they are. And I just know that watching them shoot, they're just not. They're okay. Mm-hmm. If you take your average cop, society thinks their skill level's here. Skill level's really here. SWAT cops are just like right there, just a touch above them. Mm-hmm. But go train. Get better at everything. Bust your ass, be humble, keep your mouth shut, learn, and work for it. I mean, that's no one's handing anything to you. If it's worth getting it, then you're going to work for it. No one's going to give you jack. So train. That's the biggest thing I tell guys. Go do it. Do it on your own because your agency's not going to do it for you.
That's awesome. True that. And I know that as like in the military too, like you got to get after it. If you want specific training, you kind of got to go after it.
You got to be the squeaky hinge, man. Hey, LT, you can send me airborne school. You can send me this school. Mm-hmm. You can send
squeaky
me here.
Squeaky wheel gets the oil,
yeah,
man.
Come on, man. Send me. Yeah. You got to do it or you won't go anywhere. Yep.
Absolutely. Prove yourself. Absolutely. Like you were saying, man,
always
get after it. The best thing there that you said was shut your mouth, man.
Yeah. You know,
be humble.
Yeah. You shut your mouth, put your ego at the door. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest thing. Gun side, you know, we talked a couple times about jiu-jitsu and we talked before we got rolling here that, that's the biggest, you know, cops that don't get enough firearms training, the defensive tactics and combatives training. One of the biggest things I've told people over kind of really learning that and getting humbled through that process is you really don't know what you don't know till you go learn that side of it. Mm-hmm. And like you're really further behind that eight ball than you think. And most officers win 99% of the fights they're in. And even if they get unlucky and they're starting to get their ass handed to them in a fight, backups there fast enough and they get out of it. And just because they had a good outcome, they think that, okay, well, I'm okay. What I'm doing now is all right. And I worked my whole career. You know, I work with guys that work 30 years and never got in a real serious fight. Our guys got in serious fights and just before it started to get to the point where it would have been possibly deadly to them, the cavalry arrived and they were okay. I'm not leaving that to chance myself personally. You know, go out there and do that. But that takes, like, you know, that takes a massive ego check because you're going to walk in day one, month one, year one and get your ass kicked. Year two, year three, year four, there's going to probably be somebody in that school kicking your ass.
Yeah, definitely.
Like you're not going to be the big bad crusher you think you are. You're going to get beat and you're going to get beat. And, you know, you're going to step in as a white belt and have some higher level blue belt or low level purple belt girl kick your ass or you not be able to do a thing with her. Like, she's on the mat rolling with you and you're like, she's 100 pounds and I can't beat her.
Yeah.
Like she isn't big enough to, like, I can brute strength my way through that she can't choke me, but I can't beat her. If I had to arrest her, I couldn't arrest her. Mm-hmm. She's kicking my ass. And that's, you gotta be willing. A lot of guys get that and go, oh, I'm out here. And you know, the humble bug comes in and they're like, this hurts too much. So,
yeah. Well, so with law enforcement, this is kind of just a question that popped into my head here. What do you recommend as like maybe the most, you know, important martial art? Like, I think, like you were saying, jiu-jitsu is definitely important, but
yeah,
do you think, you know, boxing might be good because you want to make sure you're good in your stand up to keep them at a distance.
Yeah, so
like a perp, you know, a crazy perp that's trying to
attack. Yeah, I mean it's like anything else. It's a rounding and being rounded in that, being rounded in your overall defensive strategy. So while I think you'd be great to have a component of jiu-jitsu, you'd be good to have some form of stand-up component, whether it's boxing, whether it's Muay Thai, just something to put yourself up standing. In practical application, at some point, you hit a limit, and guys don't. If I had to pick one, what I would tell guys, jiu-jitsu. If you could just pick one, even though
Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
You have a, okay, you know, you could arguably say you have a gap in striking. But when it gets to that level, I've never seen a fight in the street with officers and suspects ever look anything like an MMA match where the striking that occurred was clean and was rule-based. And what happened, typically the striking that occurs in every fight I can ever think of, either being in or witnessing, striking is entangled. So it's gross motor and it's entangled. And there's ways to be better at that. But yeah, I mean, like you said, if you put that time, you had that time commitment available, having a component of a stand-up capability and also a ground capability or a more rounded capability like a jiu-jitsu is great. I just know a lot of guys don't have it. So if they had to pick one, I say BJJ.
Yeah.
And that you're starting to see that echo a lot. I mean, that's not something, jiu-jitsu certainly isn't new. It's not even new in law enforcement. It's just been picking up speed massively over the last 5 years. Yeah. Where 5 years ago, you bumped into a cop that did jiu-jitsu, it was one out of every 1,000. Now you bump into one out of every 30 or 40 cops that are doing, or at least dabbling. And I'm in that. I'm in by no means a dedicated practitioner. And when Eric watches this, he's probably going to laugh and be like, when's the last time you've been to the school? And
I'm going, oh, man.
But you're going to have, you know, one out of 30, 40 guys that are there, you know, at a minimum, a couple times a year, if not a couple times a month, or once a week, or twice a week, or something like that. And you're getting dudes in every agency now bumping into most regions. If I teach a sold out class, 24, 25 cops, there's one guy in there that's a high purple, brown, or a black belt. You know, a dude that's been training for 4, 5, 6, 7, 10 years is in the school. You know, is enrolling 6, 7 times a week. Is really, really getting after it very, very aggressively. So they're out there now, and they're more, and it's picking up steam. Programs like GST, like Gracie Survival Tactics and stuff like that. The Gracie's pushing a instructor-level program out to law enforcement designed to be fed. It's just kind of an introductory. That becomes an introductory program to push out to the masses to go, here's jiu-jitsu, here's how it applies to law enforcement setting.
No doubt. No, that's awesome. I actually didn't even know about that Gracie program. Yep. That's awesome. I might have to look into it. That sounds cool.
Yeah.
All right, man. So is there any last bit of information you want to give there, Phil? Before we cut out here, where can people find you?
Dude, we covered it all, man. I mean, we had a, you know, between fans coming in and rocking it, and we got into politics, and I think we covered it, dude. I'm set, man. I'm good.
Awesome. So where can people find you on, like, social media and everything?
Yeah, so everything bases out of VIGRTraining, VIGRTraining.com. You find me on Instagram, Facebook. Website's just VIGRTraining.com.
Mm-hmm.
Catch me there. Follow along on the adventures and keep up to date. So that's where you get me.
All right, man. Well, thanks a lot for coming on.
Yeah, brother. My pleasure.
Yep. All right.